Welcome, everyone, to the fourth meeting in 2016 of the Rural Economy and Connectivity Committee. Everyone is reminded, please, to switch off their mobile phones. No apologies have been received before the meeting. The first item on the agenda is to take evidence on the draft prohibited procedures on protected animals, open brackets, exemption, Scotland, amendment regulations 2016. And I'd like to welcome the Cabinet Secretary, Fergus Ewing, Mike Palmer, who's the Deputy Director of Fisheries Marine Scotland, Andrew Vose, the Veterinary Advisor, and Barry McCaffrey, the Solicitor, all from the Scottish Government. The instrument is laid under an affirmative procedure, which means Parliament must approve it before the provisions can come into force. Following the evidence session, the committee will be invited the next agenda item to consider a motion to approve the instrument. Can I therefore ask the Cabinet Secretary to make a short opening statement on this instrument, please?
Thank you and good morning to members. The statement is of necessity fairly detailed, convener, and I welcome the opportunity to explain to the committee our proposal for amending the prohibited procedures on protected animals, and hope committee members will concur with the rationale and the requirement for this secondary legislation. We need to change the current legislation to allow for the operation of the Beef Efficiency Scheme. This is explained more fully in the accompanying policy document. The Beef Efficiency Scheme was developed alongside NFU Scotland and has broad sector support. It aims to improve the sustainability of beef production through improved breeding stock and in particular to reduce greenhouse gas emissions. It represents a major investment of some £45 million in the Scottish beef sector to improve the efficiency, sustainability and quality of the Scottish beef herd. The scheme will help to increase herd profitability and form part of our world-leading approach to tackling climate change and will benefit our environment both locally and globally. A key element of the BES will entail tissue tagging of 20% of farmers' calves for genotyping, enabling the scheme to build up genetic data on the herd. The tags punch out a small tissue sample into a sealed container, which can then be sent for testing. In this way, the tags are different to official identification tags, which do not normally remove a tissue sample from the animal. I have with me examples of both types of tags so committee members can see what they look like and see the differences. Perhaps we could pass them round. The tagging will enable the active use of whole life data on animals and active planning to help improve cattle genetics and management practice on farms. Thus, the proposed secondary legislation applies only to bovine animals. Under Section 20 of the Animal Health and Welfare Scotland Act 2006, it is an offence to carry out or cause a prohibited procedure which involves interference with sensitive tissues or bone structure of a protected animal. However, Scottish ministers may by regulations exempt any procedure which is carried out for a purpose which in such manner as and in accordance with such conditions as specified in any regulations. Currently, the prohibited procedures on protected animals, exemptions, Scotland regulations 2010 as amended, the 2010 regulations include an exemption to enable ear tagging for bovine animals, pigs, sheep, goats and deer for the purposes set out above. However, these regulations do not allow for ear tagging for any other purpose, including genetic analysis. Hence, this statutory instrument is required to allow for the further exemption which would allow the tagging of bovine animals for the purpose of genetic analysis. It is important to note that this would not allow any new procedures to be undertaken in addition to ear tagging, but would simply extend the scope of the current exemption. The first wave of calves to be genotyped will be this autumn, before they're sold at market, in order to fit in with industry needs. In short, to ensure that as many calves as possible can be captured for tagging in year one of the Beef Efficiency Scheme before they are sold on. We are keen to obtain approval, if Parliament and the committee so decide, for this statutory instrument before Parliament breaks for recess on the 8th of October. As required in terms of the provisions in the 2006 Act, we have carried out a short, targeted consultation of 5 weeks' duration, which ran from the 26th July to the 29th of August. This took account of the highly technical and narrow nature of the proposed exemption and the fact that we are not proposing to allow any new procedures in addition to ear tagging, only to expand the scope of the currently permitted procedures so that they can be used for this specific purpose. There were 21 responses submitted to the consultation, 15 of which were supportive of the proposed legislative change. These supportive responses represented organisations as diverse as the National Farmers Union for Scotland and Animal Concern. There were 5 responses from individuals opposed to the measure and 1 response which made no indication of support or opposition. Among those opposing the proposal, reservations were raised about the impact of additional tagging on the welfare of animals. Ear tagging does cause momentary pain and discomfort at the time of application, but there are rarely any longer-term adverse effects on the animal, and the risk of infection can be minimised by storing and applying tags in hygienic conditions. The welfare implications of applying a tissue tag are equivalent to those arising from the application of identity tags, which of course are already permitted. Furthermore, as a result of genetic sampling and the resultant improvements in genetic selection, we expect to see cumulative and permanent benefits to the national herd in respect of growth rates, feed conversion, maternal behaviour, nutritional practice, and disease resistance. I hope these opening remarks and the accompanying documents we have supplied have explained the background and the rationale for this proposal, and myself and my officials will be happy to answer any questions that members may have. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary. There's a few of us, I think, round the table before we ask any questions would just like to declare an interest. I would like to declare an interest as a cattle breeder and farmer, and having used tags in the past. I think Peter may want to say something.
Well, similarly, I am obviously a farmer in Aberdeenshire. I have agricultural interests, and I refer members to my register.
Is there anyone else? Do you have an interest to declare?
I have 3 acres on which sheep are.
Okay, so if that's all right, that everyone knows that there are people with interests, that I'd like to ask the Cabinet Secretary, if I may, to start with, what other methods were considered before using ear tags, such as the use of hair samples, as have been done with pedigree breeds for over 10 years, to provide the same information?
Well, I think that's a very apt question, the answer to which I read earlier, but I'm sure my officials will locate the details. But I think the question is a good one, because obviously before we approve any change which involves any issue of animal welfare, we need thoroughly to examine what alternative measures there were for serving the purpose which I described in the opening remarks. And therefore, there are, I understand, this is from memory, and my officials will help me out and mark this answer out of 10, but I think the alternatives were taking samples of hair, which involved practical difficulties about cleanliness, nasal sampling as well, which involved other practical difficulties, and one other method, I think, but I'm sure Mr. Vos will come in and provide a more comprehensive and authoritative answer. Andrew.
Thank you. Yes, the other methods available are basically blood sampling, taking hair samples, or nasal swabbing. But in this particular case, we want to consistent, high-quality DNA sample, and the best and most reliable way of doing that is with a tissue tag sample. Blood sampling would be a valid alternative, but that requires a vet to come in and take the blood sample, and obviously there's sort of practical and cost difficulties in arranging for vets to come in and sample every animal. So the tissue tag sample gives a good, consistent, high-quality sample of tissue that's suitable for the DNA extraction that's being proposed for the BES scheme.
Can I push you just a wee bit on that? Is that, as far as I'm aware, hair samples do exactly the same and actually form the basis of what BCMS use as a requirement for identifying animals without passports. Certainly all the breed societies would use hair sample and find it very effective, and it's somewhat less invasive than an ear tag. Although I do have to say that ear tagging has to go on, so this is a minor change, but I'd just like to know, and I think people outside the Parliament would like to know, that non-invasive methods have been looked at.
Yeah, I think the hair sampling was considered in detail, but I think there are problems if you're taking a large number of samples, as will be the case in this scheme. There are problems of hygiene and consistency of collection, so if you do it very carefully, you can get a good sample, but if you're taking large numbers, I think you need a consistent, repeatable way of doing it, rather than hair sampling, which might be subject to the vagaries of farmers adopting different techniques, or maybe not doing it in the most hygienic conditions, which would lead to a sample that was contaminated and had to, you know, might lead to resampling.
Okay, Stuart had a question.
Cabinet Secretary, you made something of the fact that this will help our climate change plans. My knowledge is incomplete, but I understand that there's considerable genetic variability in the amount of methane that is emitted from various bovines, rumens, partly from diet and partly from different bacteria that live in individuals' rumens, but there is a genetic part. Is that what you're referring to when you look to get a benefit for our climate change efforts in reducing the methane from the rumen of bovines by breeding selectively for those that will emit less methane, or do you have something else in mind?
Well, that's certainly an important component of the rationale behind these rules and the beef efficiency scheme, and that is a very major scheme involving, as it does, I think, £45 million of financial support towards the sector, which is a very substantial contribution. And I'll bring in the experts again to give an authoritative opinion, but my understanding, and indeed from a meeting with Jim McLaren and Julie Morton of the meeting of Quality Meat Scotland yesterday, is that a key component of the quality of our herd is that one must have as healthy stock as possible, and healthy stock tend to emit less methane. Putting it crudely, I hope I haven't misunderstood that, but that's certainly one of the objectives, one of the aims of the beef efficiency scheme, is to further drive up the quality of our herd. And indeed, I think the committee would benefit at some point, not for me to dictate committee business, but from an exposition from QMS of the kind of the wider the policy aims and the benefits and the considerable advantages that we enjoy actually at the moment in terms of the relatively low consumption of protein that our herd consumes in relation to the international average, which is quite remarkable statistics. But in any event, going back to the original question, perhaps I could bring in Mr. Vos if he could expand on what I've already said.
Mike.
Certainly, yes. Yeah, I mean, the scheme is very much about gathering together a data bank that will allow us to introduce more efficient farming techniques and management practices that will reduce those emissions coming from methane. So, for example, we will be gathering data on the sire identity, on the calving ease, the calf figure, the calf weight, the cow docility. We will be gathering from the genotyping samples phenotypes, which are the traits of the different cattle. And from that, we can put together a meta database for the Scottish herd. And at farm level, there will be an advisory service put in place within the scheme for each member of the scheme, so that the farmer can talk one-to-one with an advisor and in a group setting with an advisor to talk through how the data that they have gathered on their herd can then be applied to more efficient farming techniques. And this is based on evidence in terms of the fact that we have looked at a scheme, a very similar scheme that was pioneered in Ireland, which has had successful results. So we're not going into this blind. We're going into this on the basis of very good evidence from a pre-existing scheme. And that has shown that gathering the data in this way gives us that information that allows us to improve the efficiency and therefore reduce the emissions.
Just you might not be seeing, but I can see various members of the committee catching my eye around the table, and there are some questions lining up. So I would, if I can finish, please, Chair, is without meaning to reduce the quality of your answers, maybe we could keep them as short as possible and as punchy as possible so I can get everyone in. Otherwise, I think afterwards they will be after me, not you. So, Stuart, if you'd like to just follow very quickly.
It's just to clarify, you said metadatabase. I would understand metadata to be data that describes the use of data rather than being a database. What do you mean when you use metadatabase?
Well, yeah, that was, yeah, perhaps that it was wrong to say metadata.
Well, that's okay.
In that technical respect, I'm meaning a database that you build a database of the whole herd, as well as at farm level. So you have it at two levels.
That's fine. Thank you, convener.
Okay, Peter is next.
Yeah, I have some questions about the practicalities of the thing. I mean, I thank you for coming along with an example of the tag, because I was interested to know what was actually going to be printed on the tag. But it would appear if that's how it's going to look, the herd number and everything else will be on that tag. Because I had a thought it might be a more like a management tag, which is a blank tag that you can write, you know, your information on it. And we actually put in three tags, and the third tag is a management tag, and that we write on with the pen. And that might have been more suitable, because then if it's going to be like that, I'm going to have four tags in our cattle. The two that we have to put in, the third one, which is the sample one, and then a management tag on top of that. So my suggestion might have been that a blank management tag might have been more suitable for for that one. The other question, if the cattle lose this tag before they are slaughtered, does it have to be replaced? And the third question is the farmer responsible for ordering these tags, or do these tags arrive on site because you know that we keep cattle?
Mike, do you want to answer all those practical points?
Yeah, so the first question, yes, the genotype tag will have the identity of the calf printed on it. To make sure that we've got the right calf and we can trace it all the way back. If a tag, for some reason, becomes dislodged from the calf, then that is a circumstance that we will deal with on a case-by-case basis. We would obviously then be in communication with the farmer about how to respond to that. Now, it may be that it's felt that if it's just one calf, that we can let that go, if you like, that it doesn't affect the bank of data sufficiently for us to need to go back and re-tag or whatever. But we will deal with that on a case-by-case basis in a pragmatic and practical fashion. The third question, I think, was about the supply of the tags. So the tags will be sent out to the farmers. The farmers will be told before the tags are sent out which calves are going to be sampled and which have been identified for tagging. And then the tags will be sent out free of charge to them. All they need to do is to apply the tag, take the sample, send it back to the lab. There's no payment involved for the producer. And the transportation and the processing of the tag is all done by the lab.
I mean, just to follow up, you are aware that the tags get lost on a fairly regular basis, and it would be good if there was a pragmatic approach to that, because, we're only starting with 20% anyway, so I would welcome that answer, because it could become a very complex issue if you've got to apply for these special tags and replace these as well as all the other tags that we know we do have to replace anyway. Okay, thank you.
I think it's a very sensible point Mr. Chapman's raised. We will take that away, look at it. I'm very keen that, you know, we shouldn't have any undue penalties, and that should not be the approach that we take, but whilst ensuring that the rules are properly observed. So we'll take that away and write to the committee on this matter.
Richard, you.
Good morning, Cabinet Secretary. Many of the questions I was going to ask have just been answered. But how many, you know, cattle have tags on them just now, so how many tags is a cow going to have? Four, three, two, one?
Andrew.
Yeah, well, cattle are, at the moment, they're legally required to have two identification tags. They could well, as Mr. Chapman said, have a management tag. They might have a BVD testing tag.
So, and rising?
So, yes, and there may well be the need for replacement tags if tags are removed. So
honestly need multiple tags? You know, I'm not a farmer. I'll declare I'm not a farmer, but I've seen cows at the Royal Highland Show and excellent beef cattle that we have, excellent herds. But could these tags that we've just seen replace the other tags, or are we actually physically going to have cows walking about in fields with five, six, seven tags on them?
Well, there is the possibility for the BS sample to be taken from one of the primary identification tags. So that option is already in the scheme. And that's possibly something we could look at in the future.
Yeah, can I suggest that the tags that I've seen, which look very good, replaces the original tags, or the first tag that goes on an animal at the end of the day, which, you know, we don't need multiple tags. All we need is maybe one or possibly two. Can I put that suggestion to you? I think that's a yes.
I don't think it's a yes.
No, I don't think it's a yes. We'll go away,
and since we're going to write to the committee, I mean, it's a perfectly valid question, and the proliferation of tags is one of the issues that was raised. You know, how many tags was it reasonable in terms of animal welfare to put? My understanding is it's not the case that we're talking as many as you've mentioned, but we'll take it away, and we'll provide a specific answer to the committee. Unless we can do so now, Mike.
If I can, convener, sorry, Mr. Palmer, you know, driving along the road and people go out in the countryside, we see cows putting their heads up and down against fences or whatever, and the point that's been ably made, you know, I'm sure some of these tags will come off, you know, so I think we've got to minimise. I think we've got to do it. I agree with the SSI, but I would suggest that we don't need multiple tags on a cow.
I think you're being asked, and I would certainly follow up Richard's comment in the sense that you've got your two mandatory tags. You could have this tag. You could have a fourth metal tag as well if you're in a pedigree herd and you want to keep a registration. And you could have a management tag as well. So it could end up, you know, looking better than going out on a Saturday night with lots of earrings. But I think from a cow's point of view, the less we have in the ear, the less chances are they'll catch. So I think you're being asked to maybe look at that again. Could I just move on to Jamie? Well, I got the impression the Cabinet Secretary didn't want to give an answer there, but maybe if he does, he's welcome
well,
to
I mean,
do
if
so.
Mike can provide any more information, that might be of use.
By way of background, to say that we have looked very carefully at that option in developing the scheme, because our aspiration is to reduce the number of tags as far as we can on cattle. Clearly, it would be preferable, more efficient and better for the cattle if we can reduce the number of tags. The situation that we're in at the moment is that because this is quite a groundbreaking and new scheme, and genotyping is a new development for cattle, that we need to be very careful in scientific terms about the number of variables that we can control. And by having a separate tag, we are controlling the number of scientific variables that we have. And our scientists gave us very clear advice. That would be advisable at the current time. But to just back up what the Cabinet Secretary said, we are very open to trying to streamline that in future years. We have more years of this scheme coming, so we will look towards streamlining. in the future.
Jamie, you had a question.
Thank you, Convener. I think my first question perhaps is to Mr. Palmer, and that's my second is to the Cabinet Secretary. The first being, I presume the point of the tagging is the collection of the tissue sample, and I just wonder what is the point of the tag itself? Is that just to identify that a tissue sample has been taken? In other words, if it's just a one-off event, surely there would be another method of using the ear to take a tissue sample and but not leave any permanent legacy of that sample having been taken. I just wondered what, given that it's not an ongoing process, what the point of the tag is for the duration of the life of the animal.
Well, I think maybe that goes back to a certain extent to the point that we discussed before about alternative methods of taking samples. So one could take a sample through hair samples or through a blood sample, but as we've discussed, there are various difficulties in that. So tagging is the most efficient and reliable way of taking a high quality sample. It so happens that means that there is then a tag applied. But we've looked at the other methods of doing that, which wouldn't involve a tag, and it's just not sufficiently reliable.
Okay, thank you.
With the current technology.
Yeah, I think the other point is that the tag provides a permanent record that ties that sample definitely to the animal from which it was taken.
That's two. Okay. And my second question briefly is to the Cabinet Minister, and that's on the scheme itself. Is this a mandatory scheme? Perhaps it's already in the notes here, but I just wanted to double check. Given that it's we're looking to go for 20% of herds at the moment, will all farmers be automatically sent the tags, or will they have to sign up to the scheme proactively, and do they have to sign up, and if so, what is the benefit to the individual farmer in addition to the wider benefits of the scheme?
Well, the scheme is not a mandatory scheme in respect that we were not obliged by law, EU law or otherwise, to deliver it. We brought it forward in order to promote further the success of the beef sector in Scotland, believing that with the advice that we had, that to promote beef efficiency, as has happened in Ireland, is a key method of improving the quality of our stock and thereby the profitability and success of the sector in Scotland, particularly in a very competitive position in relation to cheaper beef coming in from places such as Argentina and even Ireland. I think that's the answer to the first question about the scheme itself. I think the rest of the questions were perhaps more of a technical nature. If I could ask Mike to address them, please.
Certainly, yes. So what benefits do the farmers gain from the scheme? Well, there is a financial payment that is given to each member of the scheme to compensate the member for the tasks that we're asking the farmer to deliver for the scheme. So there is a yearly payment that the farmer gets. And then, of course, there are benefits beyond that which will accrue from the more efficient farming practices that result from the scheme. And as the Cabinet Secretary has said, you know, we are very confident that that is going to deliver much higher standards of and much better outcomes for our beef herd in the future, more profitability as a result.
Thank you.
I'm not seeing there's any more questions. There is just one thing I'd just like to push, if I may, the Cabinet Secretary on, is just the replacement of these tags once the information has been gathered and the genetic details of the individual calf has been recorded against the animal on the database that will be kept and be kept by farmers. Should the tag get lost, and Mike, with the greatest respect, tags do get lost probably more regularly than you perhaps accept. I would ask that a pragmatic approach needs to be a really pragmatic approach on whether to go back and re-tissue sample again with the same tag, just to get the same use. Well, it won't be used data at that stage, just for the sake of having a tag in an animal. So could I push the Cabinet Secretary to be as pragmatic on that as possible?
Well, yes, I think I've already indicated that, you know, we take the point as raised earlier as one that's an important one. It's not one that we should brush aside, but we should look at and consider very carefully. We want to take a pragmatic, not a penal approach to this, but, you know, we have to observe that the scheme does require the rules to be met, otherwise the benefits therefrom will not be realised. So the process of inspection, which routinely takes place, of course, will check the tags, and we need to take a pragmatic approach. On the specific issue of replacement, I don't know if you have anything to add, Mike, or whether we'll just come back to committee later.
No, I don't think I have anything to add. I absolutely agree that we will need to take as pragmatic approach as we possibly can, and that's certainly the spirit in which we will be delivering the scheme. Yep. Mm.
So unless there's any other questions, I'd like to thank the Cabinet Secretary and his officials for the evidence that they've given. It's been very helpful. Okay, I'd like to go on to the second agenda item, which is the formal consideration of motion S5M01446, calling for the committee to recommend the approval of the draft prohibited procedures on Protected Animals Exemption Scotland Amendment Regulation 2016. I invite the Cabinet Secretary to speak to and move that motion.
I think I'll just refer to the remarks I've already made, which were not short. Moved.
I invite any further comments and questions from the members. Mike.
I think from the questions that have gone ahead and the responses that we've had, that there seem to be, this is an enabling legislation to enable tags to be fitted to cows, to animals, and I think it should be supported for obvious reasons. But I do have a question on, I would like the minister at some stage to consider bringing forward legislation, an instrument to say there should be a maximum number of tags on an animal, because I think for animal welfare perspective, I think that's important.
If the minister wants to answer that, I feel that the minister's given a clear indication that this is going to be looked at, and as his officials, and I think your comments are very much noted because they reflect the position that the committee's taken. Richard.
I think we should support the SSI, and actually the point I was going to make as Mr. Rumbles, that the fact that I'm sure the Cabinet Secretary has taken away the suggestion that we certainly look at and minimise the number of tags that go on animals, and I'm quite happy that the scheme will be of benefit to the producers of beef in this country, and I'll support it.
Okay, so on the basis there are no one's caught my eye, there's no further comments or questions. The question is that whether motion S5M01446 in the name of Fergus Ewing be approved. Are we all agreed?
Agreed.
If we're agreed, then we are agreed. Thank you. That concludes the consideration of this affirmative instrument, and we'll report our outcome to the Parliament. I'd like to suspend the meeting briefly to allow the Cabinet Secretary and his team to adjust before the next session. Ladies and gentlemen, the third item on the agenda is to take evidence from the Cabinet Secretary for the Rural Economy and Connectivity on the Common Agricultural Policy payments. The Cabinet Secretary has now been joined by two different officials, David Barnes, who's the Chief Agricultural Officer, and Jonathan Price, who's Director of the Agriculture, Food and Rural Communities. Both are from the Scottish Government. I welcome you both to the meeting. We've got a huge amount to cover in a fairly short time, so I'd like to go straight into questions from the members, if I may. And the first question I've got down is relating to payments, and it's from Stuart.
Thank you, Convener. Fairly simple questions. I'll ask two questions, if I may. How much is now being paid out under the basic payment scheme, greening and the young farmer payment, preferably in pounds, and the NFUS are suggesting that 9% of the 2015 budget has not yet been paid out. Is that the figure you have, and when do we expect to reach near or at 100%?
Well, thank you. And to answer Mr. Stevenson's questions, first we have continued, I think, to make fairly solid progress since my statement to Parliament last week. The figures are published weekly, as members will know. As at 16th September, the total in respect of BPS greening and young farmer payments stands at £329 million to 17,866 claimants. 17,634, I'm advised, have received payment in full. Members will be aware that we publish this data each Friday based on figures at close of play the previous Wednesday. As to what remains to be paid, it should be remembered that the government has offered loans to farmers who have not yet been paid to provide cash flow. Around 90% of these loan payments have been recouped. Turning to the second, I think that answers the first question, Convener. The second question is that it's estimated that £4 million remains to be paid under the beef and sheep schemes, and the net amount remaining to be paid under the BPS greening and young farmer schemes, the Pillar 1 schemes, after allowing for loans, is 5 to 6 million, giving a total of around 9 to 10 million for the Pillar 1 schemes. And finally, just let me reiterate what I said before. Getting this right, getting this sorted in full, is my top priority. A huge amount of work has been devoted to that, and I personally won't be satisfied until every farmer has received payment of their due in total.
Okay, sorry. I'm going to call Mike now.
Thanks for that response, Minister, but it doesn't quite square with what I've got here. On the 17th of July, I asked a parliamentary question to you, and you were good enough to respond to me yesterday, and you said yesterday that the latest figures showed there were 473 farm businesses that had received nothing, and there were 230 farm businesses which had received something. And I'm not sure that, I mean, I just got this from you yesterday, and I'm not sure how that squares with the figures you've got today. Could you just repeat, so that I've got this clear, how many farm businesses remain to have so far received absolutely nothing?
Well, most of the figure which you mentioned will have received loan payments, and I want to make
that clear. No, I'm not talking about
loan
payments, I'm talking about the money that they're due.
You know, I am being asked to come up with a very large number of statistics, and I'll do my best. I think I need some assistance from officials here, because the last thing I want to do is provide any incorrect figure through inadvertence, and these are important and complex matters. So perhaps I can ask Mr. Price to say where we are in respect of the specific matters that Mr. Rumbles has raised.
Okay, so as the Cabinet Secretary has said, almost everybody who has not yet received an EU payment has been given a loan or has been offered a loan. So there are certainly fewer than 100 claimants that have not had either a loan or their EU payment.
I'm not talking about loans, I'm talking about the money that is due to them.
Yes, yeah. So in terms of the EU payments, the data you've got, which is in the PQ, which it relates to the position as of last Wednesday, mm-hmm. I believe it states that there are 473 businesses
that's right.
That are still to be paid.
Have received nothing.
They're still to be paid. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And there is a further 230 that have received a first installment, which will be about 80% of their payment. But those 230 will be still awaiting mm-hmm. the balance, which will be roughly 20%.
So these are correct figures.
Those 230
that have received something and 473 that have received nothing.
Total paid in full, 617,634.
Okay, thank you very much.
Okay. Well, I mean, I understand the vast majority of the 473 will have received the offer of a loan. Well, I'm just putting it into perspective because...
My question was about
But I think I'm entitled to point out that you said they've received nothing. That is not, I believe, factually accurate. They will, in almost all cases, have received a loan. They will certainly have received a loan. And the information I have, Convener, just to finish this off, is that over 99% of eligible claimants have either had the cap payment or the offer of a loan. So I wouldn't want anybody to misrepresent the numbers of claimants who've received nothing whatsoever financially, and I'm sure Mr. Rumbles would not wish to do that either.
Convener, I would like the Minister not to obfuscate here. The point is, I'm not talking about loans. When a loan is given to a farm business, it is not covering their whole amount of money that they're due. You made that clear. My question is simply... On the two issues here, the information that you gave me yesterday in this parliamentary answer was that 230 farm businesses have received part payment of the money that they were due 9 months ago, and 473 farm businesses have received no money that they were due, but you say they've been given a part loan.
Right.
The point I'm making is I want to know, and I'm just having this confirmed just now, that 473 farm businesses you said unpaid. They haven't been processed. The point is 230 farm businesses have been processed and have received part payment. And what you're telling me basically is, you're telling the committee that 473 farm businesses have not been processed. I just want to make sure that we've got the figures right, because we can't discuss anything unless we understand what the figures actually mean, and that's the point.
Well, I think we're kind of struggling to agree here. You know, we're not disagreeing. The figure of 473 has been confirmed, and I put it in context that that does not mean that those individuals have received nothing at all, but that most of them will have received a loan payment, and in most cases, the loan payment will have been of the order of 80% of the Pillar 1 entitlement. Now, I think it would be useful, Convener, just to focus in on this, that every year there is a tail of difficult cases which, for one reason or another, have not been settled in full. And I think it would be very helpful if officials could describe what these cases involve. Some members, especially those in the farming community, will know that there are difficulties regarding reductions, exclusions, private contract, cross-border cases, and entitlement cases. And all of these cases exist every year and pose particular difficulties, and some claims are not eligible at all. So I think it would be useful, I think, Convener, to avoid any misunderstanding, if there was an opportunity for Mr. Price just to add to anything I've said about the fact that there always is a tail of cases. There is a higher tail this year than before, I accept, and we are working very hard to get through the cases. As I said before, I will not be satisfied until every farmer has received payment in full. Jonathan.
Jonathan, before you go in, if I may, I think the Cabinet Secretary has been quite clear that there's a tail, and I think we accept that. And I think you've given a very full answer, for which I'm thankful, and you've explained what the tail could include. So to add to that, I'm not sure would be that helpful. I think what would be helpful is to clarify and ask Cabinet Secretary to ask his officials to come back to us post the meeting, just to clarify so we all understand, of those 473 people, what how many of them have been paid, and how many have by use of a loan, and how many of them have received nothing. And I think that to chase that round any more would be, perhaps be unhelpful. Can I? Peter was just next, and what I should have said, Cabinet Secretary, and I'd like to make clear to Jonathan and David, but I declared an interest at the start of this meeting that I am a farmer and I am part of a farm partnership. Peter Chapman has made the same declaration. I'm happy to make the same declaration again, but I believe I've made it. So, and I believe Peter's made it. So I'd like to move straight on to Peter and then come on to you, if I may.
Convener, we all know there's been a problem of payment, but there's also been a problem of explanation, a problem of documentation. You know, this was a new scheme, and no farmer at the start of this scheme knew exactly how much he was going to get under the new scheme. And what's happened is, as payments have come out, there's been very little explanation, very little documentation to explain what's been paid. You know, sums have arrived in bank accounts, no explanation. Is there more money to come? Is this all we're going to get? It's created huge difficulty out there because farmers have had no ability to plan ahead to get a feel for if there is more money to come or if that's the total sum. And there's that backlog of explanation, documentation is still out there, and that's something that needs to be cleared up as well. Well, I fully appreciate we need to get the money out, but we also need to get the explanation out as to how you've come to this sum of money and whether that is the total amount that is due.
Sorry, I'm actually going to make a comment to Peter as well, is that there's a huge amount of questions here, so can I ask the members of the committee to keep the questions short and respect the Cabinet Secretary and his team's opportunity to get their answers out and short as well. Sorry.
I think it is a matter of record that there was, in relation to the IT difficulties, the administration of an extremely complex scheme, as will be known, where land is divided into three categories. Where we have 4 million hectares, 400,000 fields, each the average size of five football pitches, and where the need for accuracy is such that the permissible area of error for the purposes of audit, for the purposes of assessing disallowance, is a goalmouth area. So the complexity of the scheme is well understood by farmers. On the topic of explanation, I think farmers are aware that the scheme is complex. I think, of course, they all knew there were difficulties with the IT. I believe it was the case that the loan scheme, the nature of the loan scheme, was clearly explained and was by and large appreciated. And coming to looking forward, I entirely accept that there is a need for explanation. And that explanation was, I think, provided, I hope, by myself at the statement last week in relation to the 216 loan scheme, which will inject up to £300 million into the rural economy in the first weeks of November, at a time when I think some farmers may be making decisions about investment, about feed and fuel, about fertilizer, about purchase of new tractors and equipment and possibly sheds and other investments and improvements in their farm or croft. So I think there is a need for an explanation. I am not sure that it's fair to say that there's been no explanation, but I'm very conscious of the need for an explanation. In that regard, I can assure Mr. Chapman that in relation to the forthcoming loan scheme, we have an appointed official in charge. We have a team of five working on it. I personally have been involved in two drafts of the letter to farmers, cognizant of the fact that some of the letters to farmers, I think perhaps have been couched in perhaps too much legal jargon and not enough just common, plain English. I have borne that in mind in the wording of the letter, which should go off, I believe, before or around the end of this month. And I think it's been explained that in order for farmers to get their loan, which will be in normal cases up to 80% of entitlement, that they require to complete and return the form before the 12th of October. And I welcome this as a further opportunity to make that clear. Therefore, the need for explanation is absolutely accepted, and as Cabinet Secretary, I'm determined to make sure that we provide that as best as possible. Regarding the cap payments proper, I've undertaken to come back in January to provide further information at that point. And of course, by that stage, I hope we will be able to assess all the various other issues in relation to penalties and also the administration of the cap payments proper, which I'm sure we will come on to discuss. But I think the need for explanation is an entirely fair point, and it's one that we're bearing fully in mind. I don't think there's anything else we need to add to that, David, unless you want to say anything on that in addition to what I've said.
Simply that in the, as you said, Cabinet Secretary, in terms of the big picture explanations of scheme, a great deal has been done for individual farmers on their cases. There are letters outstanding that will be sent to individuals to explain the position for their individual claim. We are prioritising getting the remaining payments out. That's our top priority at the moment, and that affects that will affect the timing with which the letters ultimately come out. We would have wished that those letters had issued sooner in an ideal world, but given where we are, the correct prioritisation, we believe, is to prioritise the remaining payments over the letters, which will then come out in due course.
Can I just clarify, Peter? I mean, you've had a fairly full answer on that. Was your question directed more at the fact that farmers didn't know the full scope of their entitlements and whether they're paid at, or whether it was a question to see what was happening in the future? Because
it was the payment window that we've been working through for the last 9 months. Really, it was an explanation of the monies that have come into bank accounts, because monies have appeared in bank accounts with no explanation, and it's fine to get the money, but you need to know if this is the total sum or if it's a part payment or what it is. And it's awful difficult to manage your business and plan ahead if you don't know if there's more to come or if that's your total sum. And that's what I was highlighting.
Just one small point to add to that. And, you know, I accept all businesses need to have a reasonable certainty and clarity about what the future holds. It is possible for farmers to log in under the IT system in order to garner this information in respect of their case, and that is one of the aspects of the scheme which I know has been useful to some farmers, although I, having said that, I'm sure I may now receive some letters of complaint that not all farmers have been able all the time to access that information, but it is one of the benefits, obviously, convener, of the IT system.
Richard.
I'm sitting here listening to some of the questions being made, and in the last session I was previously in the Rural Affairs Committee, and even I knew, and I'm not a farmer, that some of the changes were going to be made and less payments were going to be made and less applicants were going to get payments. But I want to be clear on the point of, to reiterate, the 400 odd applicants. It's not a fact that they haven't received anything, it's a factor that they have. If they haven't received their payment yet, they have been offered a loan. Can you just again confirm that? So it's not a factor that people haven't got anything, haven't been in contact with. They've got an offer of a loan, and so therefore, maybe whilst they're still waiting their payment, they have been offered a loan to tide them over.
Yes, that is certainly what we've aimed to do, and indeed over the summer, as I mentioned in the statement, in the Q&A in the statement, following the statement last week, convener, I made it clear that over the summer I asked that the records be checked at the 17 area offices to make sure that everybody had received an offer of a loan. As a result of that exercise, an additional 30 businesses were identified, and they then were offered a loan. Not everybody, of course, takes them up, but everybody has had an offer. And so I think, you know, whilst I'm not satisfied until every farmer has received payment, I was also determined to make sure that every farmer eligible should have the opportunity to obtain a loan precisely to ameliorate and mitigate their financial circumstances, which of course are extremely important. And that is why we have embarked on the loan scheme for 2016. And I was absolutely delighted that NFU President Alan Bowie said that by doing this, we showed a clear commitment to the wider rural economy. And he added, knowing that up to 80% of your support package will be delivered in early November, gives clarity and certainty to farm businesses. This announcement will have a positive impact on the whole rural economy. I was very pleased in the good working relationship I have with the NFU and its president that was the response that they made to the statement last week.
Murray.
If that's It was really on the back of that, and I know that you weren't wanting to labour too much longer than there are so many other questions that need to be asked today, but I know that the Cabinet Secretary a little earlier was going to, and the officials were going to reflect on some of the complexities that are involved in some of these cases, and I know that you said that while that might not benefit the committee to hear that today, I think that I'm not a farmer and I don't understand some of the complexities involved in those applications, so that even if we don't have time to get a full explanation on that today, if it would be possible to have that information sent to the committee to hear exactly why in some of those cases, if people haven't received a loan offer or a payment, why that is and what is holding up these other cases and why that's taking so long.
Cabinet Secretary is nodding his agreement. I mean, if it would help very briefly, if Jonathan could just give a list of the cases without explanation of some of the types of ones that were delaying, that might help Murray, but it'd be useful to have a written response to that as well.
Well, in summary, the main reasons why we've had this long tail in this particular year has been because of a number of things that are brand new in the new cap, in the more complex new cap, and therefore things that have to be done in the first year of the new regime that won't have to be done in future years. So there's a lot of allocation of land parcels, fields, to one of the three regions that is an inherent part of the calculation of the basic payment scheme. That's something we have to do this year. We don't have to do in future years, unless there's a new land that comes in. The other significant factor that has affected the tail this year has been that some of the most complex functions have required the IT to be built to properly reflect those functions, and they've taken longer to come through. So again, the development of that part of the IT is a year one issue, which should be there for future years. But as I say, it's taken longer than we would ever have expected to get some of those IT fixes in place.
Thank you.
If we may then, that we'd like to just ask the Cabinet Secretary on issues to do with extra work and input. I think that I have a question to start, if I may, is that farmers welcome the extra effort gone in to try and process this situation that we're in. But the Cabinet Secretary wrote back to me after the last meeting and gave me an indication of the extra costs in the form of extra staff time, extra overtime, extra staff required, and any expert advice that was needed. Could you summarise that again? As of today's date, Cabinet Secretary, so we actually know what the failures of this system cost, because I think that would be useful.
Well, I'll certainly give you information. I'm not quite sure I would accept the last subclause of the question, which I think added a slightly tendentious element to it, if I may say so. But we have always made it clear that in ensuring that the cap payments were delivered and the problems overcome, that we asked staff to give a more than their normal contribution, and I'm delighted that they did so. And you know, I visited 8 area offices and spoken to the staff and tried to understand, as the guy that carries the can, what the problems were and learn from them. And I can say, for example, that in terms of the overtime costs, which you've asked about before, that rural payments and inspections division area office staff, and there's 400 of them approximately, worked a total of 3,567 hours overtime between the 1st of February and the 30th of April at a cost of £106,000. That's £106,000 overtime for, this is just one statistic, there are lots of others. I mean, I can go on and on for several minutes if you want, but just think about that. Overtime, 400 staff, 106,000, 250 quid each, 106,000, small fraction of a city financier's bonus. We've got this from dedicated public servants, and I would be astonished if any member said that that was anything other than the right thing to do for farmers and a relatively modest cost for the public purse, providing for excellent work from staff who themselves are very often from or related to the farming community and who are well trusted and respected by the farmers who every day they are determined to assist to the best of their ability. So I make no apology whatsoever for this. I don't know if the Conservative policy is that this should not have taken place, but in my shoes, as the government cabinet secretary responsible, I think it was money well spent.
Okay, if I can drill you down then, cabinet secretary, you gave a figure there for a short period of time. This situation regarding farm payments, if you'd prefer it called that, has started in November last year, if not earlier, and actually went on and is still going on today, as we've heard. And you gave a small figure. I would like to actually know the total cost, if I may, for split down, as I asked at the last meeting, for the extra staff that have been employed, how many they are, how much they've cost, and the extra overtime right the way across the board. Now, I actually think the Cabinet Secretary's comment, if I may, about the staff in local offices is perfectly right. We farmers absolutely rely on them, and we're very grateful for the extra work that they've done. But we've had to ask them to do extra work, and it's only right that we account for that extra work. So I would ask if the Cabinet Secretary could give me those figures, please.
Well, I can run through them now if you want, but it will take several minutes.
I'm happy to have them as a written answer post this committee, if I may.
Well, I will certainly look and see what we've written already, and if further information is required to supplement that, I will certainly do so. But I've got a lot more information here, but I think I've kind of made the point I wanted to make.
And I think I as well. Gail, you have a question on the extra work and loans.
It was going to be on the loan scheme, and I know that it's been welcomed by all the farmers that I've spoken to. I think that most of it has actually been covered, so I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that. And also about talking about the staff in the local offices. Every time I've had to deal with them, they've been absolutely amazing, and I'd just like to add my thanks to them and all the hard work that they've done. Can the Cabinet Secretary tell us about all the different payments, because they don't all happen at the same time, and there are a number of different payments that are paid out throughout the year. So just to give us a brief outline and an understanding of when each payment happens or is due to be paid. Thank you.
Okay, well, my colleagues are more expert than this, but essentially there are two types of payments. There's Pillar 1 and Pillar 2. And the figures I referred to earlier in relation to Pillar 1, which covers basic payments, greening payments, and young farmers' payments. So that's sort of three categories. The other payments cover particular schemes which support support various different types of farming activity. In recent years, the single farm payment, which of course has been replaced by BPS and greening, were paid in December. The less favoured area support scheme in March and beef coupled support in April. For 2016-17 for BPS and greening will issue in November, with the balance starting to be paid early in the year. And we would be aiming to deliver LFAS and coupled support schemes as close to previous timescales as possible, but recognise that these could possibly be delayed by a month or so. There also, this is not on the note here, but there are also a couple of specialist schemes that are generally paid later in the year, rural payments and so on. I don't know if I wanted to give a complete answer to Gail Ross. I don't know if there's anything I missed out that Mr. Barnes or Mr. Price could add.
Yes, as members know, the Common Agricultural Policy is split into its two pillars. The Cabinet Secretary's explained what was the previous practice and the plans for the Pillar 1 schemes. Of course, he didn't give any previous practice for the sheep, Scottish Upland Sheep Support Scheme in previous years, because that was a brand new scheme in the first year of the new CAP. Those Pillar 1 payments are subject to a European payment window. Pillar 2 payments are not subject to the same payment window and have generally been made later in the year. The Cabinet Secretary's mentioned them, the Rural Priorities Scheme and the Land Managers Options Scheme. those are legacy schemes. Those are contracts which were entered into with farmers under the last Pillar 2 Scotland Rural Development Programme. And so those contracts will tail off as they come to the end of their life. We will, from 2016, begin to be paying out under the equivalent contracts under the new Scottish Rural Development Programme. So the so-called Agri-Environment Climate Scheme payments will begin and will take the place gradually of the rural priorities and the land managers' options.
Okay, and I think I'd like to move on to discuss the issue of the IT in relation to this scheme. And Rhoda has a question to start, I think.
Can I ask how much the scheme has cost to date, the IT system? What's the total budget for completion and when do you expect it to be fully complete?
Well, as at the 31st of July this year, the CAP Futures Programme has cost £140 million. The total budget for completion is £178 million. The principal cost is that of the new IT system, but the programme budget also includes other necessary elements such as staff training and programme management costs. So the two figures I think the member wanted to elucidate from me are £140 million to date and £178 million is the total
of completion. Do you have a...
It's March 17. That's the end of the duration of the programme for which the budget was set.
Okay. And will the computer system be provided at that date in the form that it was contracted, or will that have changed because of the problems that have been faced?
Well, the computer system is designed to deliver the functionality to enable the administration of the new CAP payment system. And the CAP payments from year to year change. In other words, the rules change, the programs change. And that, of course, adds to the complexity. So and the Commissioner Hogan, for example, has indicated there will be changes to, I think, BPS in this coming year. So whenever there is any change, that requires the IT solutions to be followed, the IT fixes, as they're called, or functionality to deliver various specific aspects of the scheme. So it is a dynamic scheme. It is not static, but the programme does provide the framework for delivery of payments. Of course, the budget is large, and we are mindful of the Audit Scotland reports to which we've responded in full. But I think it's reasonable to point out that although the budget was substantial, it was conceived and designed to administer payments, convener, totalling, I think, £4.6 billion. So considering the cost of the computer system in relation to the job it was to do in terms of the total figure that it was designed to enable payment to be administered, it was a relatively small percentage of that total, but you know, plainly, we have to do what we can in order to address the financial issues, and I might well be asked about that. And we certainly have achieved some reductions in the budget, which I can go into if members are interested.
Okay, so it hasn't been scaled back in any way, is that correct? Is that what you're saying? The computer system itself has not been scaled back in any way?
Well, I think it wouldn't be correct to say that. I don't in any way ever wish to mislead a parliamentary committee. I think originally there was to be intended or hoped to be functionality, for example, text messages to be delivered to farmers. And it was decided early on that with the more immediate challenges of administering payments, that additional functions such as that will have to wait for another day. So I mention that because there were originally some functions which it was desired to have, which have not been delivered, and we do not anticipate delivering them by March 17. I'm not sure if that's what the member was driving at or not.
That's what I'm driving at. It would be useful to get a note of that
from
the meeting.
I think there's one or two other aspects in that, and I'm happy to write to the committee to list any functions which, if you like, haven't been delivered. I have to say, I don't think I have received lots of letters from members diligently representing constituents and quite fairly speaking on behalf of farmers who have had problems with receiving their payments. I don't think I've received one letter complaining about the lack of a text message, but I could be wrong, and I'll check that out as well.
I think there's probably a hierarchy of need here, and money takes precedence over a text message.
Agreed.
But it would be useful to know what has been scaled back. Can I ask, given the problems that have been faced with the whole system, whether the developer is subject to any financial penalties for the delays that would cover some of the additional costs faced by the Scottish Government?
Well, obviously, we have had a long and detailed process, much of which took place prior to my appointment, of our dealings with the contractor. I myself have met Steve Thorne in June and earlier this month. We have achieved reductions in respect of the payments due under the contract. We have the details here. We are also looking and, I believe, expecting to deliver further improvements and savings, if you like, under the contract. I think we have got the details here. Neither of my officials seem to be able to find them, as far as I can see. But we have taken very seriously the task of ensuring that, as far as possible, we hold the contractor to account to deliver functionality and also to ensure that there's no elements of excess payments being paid under the contract, and that has been something that we've dealt with extremely seriously, and I'm happy to write to the committee with the details, because there have been some positive achievements, relatively minor perhaps in the scheme of things in relation to 140 million. I think the savings of a couple of million have been achieved, and further measures have been added to the contract to incentivise success going forward.
Useful to have a note of that and maybe broken down into efficiencies and also into penalties to the developer?
Mr. Price is now happy to give some more information which might be of help.
Certainly, we've been working with the contractor to press down on the costs of the system. From November, we're expecting to see a reduction of about 10% or more in the costs of the contractors. This is essentially a reduction in the costs that the main supplier is underwriting. So
there are no penalties payable.
Well, if they are unable to reduce the costs of those contractors, they've committed to us that they will bear the effect. So that could be a penalty for them. We've also.
But it's not a penalty imposed by the Scottish Government. I think I'm trying to drive at whether the contract was written in a way that had penalties built in if there was problems such as those that we're now experiencing.
Well, and the other thing that we have reintroduced are a penalty regime and a service credit regime. That means that the contractor is incentivized to meet the timetables they commit to, but also that they incur penalties if they don't meet those.
Okay, so those are additions to the contract. Those weren't in the original contract.
The original contract allows for penalties and service credit regime. What we are doing is putting them properly in place for the next period, for the remainder of this programme.
I'm sorry, I'm not following. You seem to be saying that there wasn't any penalties in the original contract. And now, because things have gone wrong, you have put some penalties in going forward, but that won't require them to pay any penalties for the mess that's gone before.
If we were to go back to the earlier periods in the programme, then the contractor has not charged for all of the work that they did.
But that's not a penalty, that's a voluntary a voluntary contribution from the contractor in good faith, would you say?
I mean, if it helps, what the contract does is not to specify a penalty regime. Okay. What it enables is that when you commit to a certain section of the work, it is something called a work order that is agreed, and those work orders can include, but don't have to include, an incentive and penalty regime. Now, in the early days of this contract, it wasn't possible because of the early stages of the work to apply a penalty and incentive regime in those work orders. It's very similar to what the Auditor General said some time ago, that this was not the sort of contract that could be awarded on a fixed price basis because the requirements were still subject to change. So now that we are much further through and we have seen significant improvement in the ability of the supplier to marshal all of the tools together, we have entered into them for future work orders this service credit penalty regime.
It just seems very strange that it's after the horse has bolted that the stable door has been shut. Can I ask about an inquiry into, can I ask the Cabinet Secretary about an inquiry into the whole IT system? I think he is on record as saying he'll deal with the problem first and then look at an inquiry into what went wrong. Can I ask what his thinking is about and certainly an independent inquiry into what's happened, and when does he think that will take place?
The member's absolutely right that I think the priority for us and for farmers is to resolve the remaining difficulties with the IT system and to restore the operation of the system to a proper footing. And anything that detracts from that process by taking senior officials away from focusing on that would, I think, be counterproductive and would certainly be most unwelcome to staff who are determined to do their job to the best of ability. And I think that point, to be fair, seems to have been accepted across the board, and I welcome that. However, there also does need to be lessons learned. And I've remarked on this in my statement early on in this session of Parliament, that, of course, we have had the benefit of a very thorough series of inquiries by the Auditor General. Here it is. We've had a Rolls-Royce inquiry already, and it has looked specifically at this. And moreover, members will recall that in this report, which wasn't actually the first report either of the Auditor General, as I understand it, into the system, that they've looked at it from the beginning. But this report, published on the 20th of May, the date of my appointment, it goes into the difficulties. It already has conducted, if you like, a forensic inquiry into these difficulties. That process continues. The Auditor General, Caroline Gardner, whom I've met to explain the work that we've done in order to move to put matters on a proper footing, has indicated that she herself is giving evidence, I think, to the Public Accounts Committee, as are Mr. Price and Liz Ditchburn from my directorate. So I believe, convener, there has been an appropriate inquiry into those aspects. It is not over, obviously. The work is continuing, and of course, we are being quite appropriately subjected to scrutiny today. That is the purpose of today, not exclusively IT, but questions have been asked and answered, and further information will be provided. So my view in this is that the work that these parliamentary committees are doing, this committee and the Public Accounts Committee, is work that you've chosen to do to hold us to account quite properly. And that work, coupled with the solid work carried out by the Auditor General, do constitute an appropriate and sufficient form of inquiry. But of course, it is for Parliament at the end of the day to decide if more needs to be done. And if members believe that more needs to be done, then I'm open to consider that. However, because of the need to deliver the task in hand, I could not see that such an inquiry were such an additional form of inquiry to be seen by anyone to be necessary. I cannot see that it would be sensible or prudent to commence that for some considerable time to come. And my view is that the parliamentary committee inquiries and the substantial, forensic, painstaking and comprehensive inquiry already conducted by the Auditor General means that, putting it in layman's terms, anything more would just be duplication, and I suspect would not actually be welcomed by many farmers who might simply see it as spending more time and money on something which has already been very thoroughly examined.
Stuart, you have a question. And I'm sorry, I'm just mindful of time because there's a lot to get through. So I just remind everyone, if you would, please to keep them as short and snappy as possible.
What I'm going to do, Convener, mindful of exactly your strictures, is suggest that this may be something that, which I'm about to ask, that is responded to in writing, because it is complex. I used to lecture postgraduate students in the management of precisely this kind of project, so my questions are very detailed and precise. The first one is, I want confirmation that there is a project office in the computer development. Right, I'm getting a nod to that. On that basis, it should be easy in about 10 minutes work on their part to give me the number of tasks there are in the work breakdown structure so that I can get a sense of how big a project it is, the number of delivery phases that they've chosen to adopt, from the change log, the number of outstanding changes that there are currently and the number of changes that have been addressed and the number of been deferred to other phases. And of the changes, the proportion that have come from the client, in other words, because as we understand the need as customers, we've made changes, and those that have come from errors. And finally, in relation to errors, in the error log, how many errors have been found? Of those that have been found, how many have been fixed? And fundamentally, what is the current estimate of the number of errors that there are still to be found? Unless anyone thinks it's impossible to predict things you haven't found, if they are not able to give me that figure, that instantly tells me that there's poor design in the testing system. And accordingly, I'd therefore like their document that describes their testing approach, if I may. These may be only of interest to me, but they will help inform how I'm able to help the committee and others later.
Well, Mr. Stevenson does, as I'm sure members appreciate, have considerable expertise and business experience of this in his former banking career. So we take seriously his questions. I think they are relevant, they're important. He's absolutely right that I'm not proposing to answer them right now, but will write to him there anent and continue to engage with Mr. Stevenson and benefit from his knowledge on one proviso, that he doesn't charge us a consultancy fee for so doing.
I'm sure he's doing it for the good of everyone in Scotland. Peter.
Thank you, Convener. I'd like to ask the Cabinet Secretary about EU penalties, disallowances. Are we not there yet?
You've got that. Was there a specific question on IT? Because I'd like to just continue on IT, because I think, Richard, you had a question on IT.
I will try and be brief, but, you know, again, I agree with Mr. Stevenson, and I'm not a farmer, I'm not an IT consultant, but at least I live in the real world. And the real world is that you had a system, Pillar 1 and Pillar 2 changed, the money went down, the number of applicants who could get that money was reduced, correct me if I'm wrong in your answer, and we had a situation where we had an IT system that, from what I got from you earlier, Cabinet Secretary, had to take into consideration what people had in land, even to a gold mouth, I think you said earlier. And people were getting paid on what they had, and some people weren't getting paid, and some people were complaining. And things. So we had a system, you know, that, and this isn't new, that the last Rural Affairs Committee discussed cap payments on several occasions and the new way that cap payments were going to come in. So can you confirm, what were the changes in the cap that caused this? What was the changes in the administration of the cap that caused this? And could we have foreseen this situation? Hindsight is a wonderful thing, but could we have foreseen that this was going to happen? And basically, I think those are the most important questions that have got to be answered.
Well, to try to answer the question briefly, I think the major changes were the agreement, which was reached after careful consideration and discussion with inter alia the NFU, that land should be divided into three categories, 1, 2, and 3. That immediately, if you like, made more complex and already a complex task. Should we have foreseen that there would have been problems? Well, I'm not blessed with the benefit of hindsight either. Perhaps the answer is yes. Perhaps everybody should have foreseen that. I don't mean this to be a political point, but to some extent, the process that we've been going through in the past few years was not dissimilar to the process that England went through in 2005, when there were even greater problems of an IT nature, which went on for several years. Anyone that wants to know more about it should read The Blunders of Our Governments by Professors Ivor King and Anthony Crewe. It makes very good reading. But the main challenge has been because of the complexity of the scheme and the need to marry the mapping of each holding and the detailed requirements about how that mapping is carried out, with a number of fixed coordinates having to be taken of various boundaries, all by hand inspection, conveyed onto a tablet, that tablet having then to convey the information onto the IT system. The communication between the tablet and the IT system has been the source of huge frustration of people who are working in the ARPID offices. You can imagine when you're trying to do your work every day and you can't complete it because of IT problems. Let's spare a thought for the people who actually have been bearing the brunt of this, the people in the offices in Dumfries and Ayr, in Galloway, in Hamilton, in Inverurie, in Inverness, in Stornoway, all of which I visited, and the sheer frustration of not being able to do their job, I think, meant that that created a bit of a demoralisation, fair to say, amongst the staff over several months last year. I think it's fair to say, however, moving to the less gloomy part of this short answer, convener, that improvements have been made since then. Specific IT fixes have been delivered for many of the schemes. The SAF form, the application form, which farmers fill in, has been a much more successful process than it was in the previous year. And that we have received assurances from CGI, our contractor, following the meeting I had most recently, that functionality will be delivered early next year to enable payments to proceed and to be delivered by the end of June, and therefore, but I think, you know, Mr. Lyle's commonsensical approach is correct. Perhaps in hindsight it just was too complex to be delivered in combination with a brand new IT system. But there we are. Hindsight
so
is a great thing.
What's the timetable that the CAP IT system contractors have committed to? And so we'll be brief. I'm often said that I'm too long taking questions. When will the system be fully functioned and complete? And I take it with all the problems that we've had this year, next year should be a plain sail.
That's not a phrase that I'm planning to use, but but I did say to Parliament, and I'll just restate that our contractor, CGI, has assured me that IT system functionality will be delivered early next year so that final processing can be undertaken thereafter. The functionality is in place, and then there are processes to be gone through before the payments can actually be made and be received by individual farmers. And, of course, in tandem with that, around 5% of farms have to be inspected every year in accordance to comply with the EU audit system. And the IT system needs special processing functionality to deal with the inspection results. And I can inform the committee that the IT contractor intends to deliver the main processing functionality needed for all cases separately from the special functionality for inspections, and that's why I mention this point. And once to conclude, Once the functionality is in place, our area offices will carry out the processing tasks to enable payments to be made.
Thank you. I'm sure the disappointment of the staff in the front line, which the Minister has made entirely clear, is echoed as well by the people who have to work with them, actually the farmers. So I think it's a two-edged thing, but I don't think either of them should be underestimated. Now, Peter wanted to move on and talk about the penalties or potential penalties.
Thanks, Convener. Yeah, I mean, following all the problems that we know all about, we may not meet all the criteria and you know, we could have EU penalties, disallowances, and these can happen for various reasons, not paying out the money on time, late issue of the final entitlement letter, for instance, failure of cross-compliance and system checks, for instance, and failure to have a land mapping system in place that meets the purpose. So there are lots of problems out there. There are lots of hurdles to jump over. So what estimate of disallowance have you made for the 2015 payments?
Well, I think I would agree with much of what the member has said, but I think it's important to say that there really are two issues here which we shouldn't conflate or confuse. Firstly, disallowance is the process of assessing penalties for making inaccurate payments. So disallowance is the process of each application being considered to ensure that the payment has been properly made and not improperly made. So that's disallowance. The late penalties applies to our role and our performance and compliance with the EU system. So I think, you know, it's important to start off from that point. But I think to answer the question that has been raised, I mean, obviously, all of us aim for 100% accuracy, but like all member states, we have in the past suffered small amounts of disallowance following audits. In other words, a small proportion of the total payments have not been properly paid in accordance with the rules. And the rules are, as Mr. Lyle has just confirmed, incredibly exacting and complex. And that in itself has been commented on unfavorably by Commissioner Hogan himself, who has recommended, and we support this, a less penal approach for farmers, a less disproportionate penalties being applied for administrative errors. This has been a long feature, I think, of the regime, and I think all parties would agree with that. The level of disallowance following audits has been of the order of 1 or 2% in previous years. This puts us in the middle of the pack compared with other member states, certainly a lot less than our friends down south. The question is asked about 215. The late payment penalties issue. Now, of course, the Auditor General in her report estimated that the total level of penalties could be between, I think, 40 and 125 million. You know, I can assure members that we do not expect that this scenario will apply. However, the process by which the cumulo penalty is computed is one which cannot be carried out until the payment period is over for the purposes of the scheme, and that date finishes, I think, on the middle of October. So only after that is it possible to do the maths. And the maths don't just involve Scotland, they involve the member state, the UK. I could go into the rules, which are incredibly complex, but perhaps suffice to say that it's not possible to give a clear answer at the moment because we haven't reached the end of the period. The computation depends not just on us, but the performance of administrations elsewhere in the UK. What I can undertake is that as soon as we can come to a conclusion as to what that figure will be, then obviously we will wish to report that quite properly to Parliament. We won't sort of sit on it for months. But I don't expect that we'll be able to do that for some time to come yet. It's incredibly complex, and I have undertaken to come back to report to Parliament in January next year. It may be that by that time I will be able to report. I certainly would like to do that. The last thing I would say is that the first thing I did, in fact, it was actually before I took the oath as a Cabinet Secretary, was to meet with the First Minister in Bute House with Commissioner Hogan, advocating that flexibility be granted. And we weren't the only ones to do so. France did so as well. And I was very pleased that our advocacy played a part in securing flexibility so that, if you like, the worst consequences will not be visited upon us. That was much appreciated from Commissioner Hogan. It does, I think, illustrate that the EU Commission is capable of being flexible and helpful in some cases, but that's a debate for another day. So I don't know if officials have anything else to add, but I hope for the reasons I've stated, the member will accept that it's not that we don't want to answer, we can't, there is no answer at the moment, there cannot be, but as soon as we've got one, we will share it with this committee.
Committee and Parliament would welcome that information as soon as it's available. And again, we're very short of time, and Murray's got a very, very quick question, and then there are two particular areas which I'd like to cover as well. So if you could keep it as brief as possible, I'd be very grateful.
Thank you, Convener. You'll be glad to hear that the Cabinet Secretary touched on the answer there in his last response, because that was what I was going to ask, was just really in terms of disallowance, what that's looked like over the last programming period, and how that has compared to the rest of the UK and across Europe as well. Like I say, I know you touched on that answer, but if you did have any sort of broad figures that it might be comparable to, then that would be helpful. Thank you.
We don't have figures yet, but as soon as we do, we will come back. I should also say that the work in the area offices, in particular in Stockton House in May, with a huge amount of money going out, there was a massive effort that was made by people in the area offices in between May and June, by the end of June, by which essentially, we have to pay 95.25%, don't ask me why the 0.25 is there, of the total of Pillar 1 in order to avoid an element of penalties. Enormous amount was done to get closer to that 95% than appeared to be possible as at the 20th of May. And for that, to all of the staff involved, I'm extremely grateful.
Thank you. Jamie, you had a question about debt in agriculture that you'd like to raise.
Thank you. Just before I move on to that, could I make a request that further to the response that Mr. Price made to Rhoda Grant's questions on penalties, I think it's still quite entirely unclear to the committee whether there's any existing financial recourse that the Scottish Government can take with the IT contractor, perhaps in writing they could follow up a more full answer as to the current situation with regards to any existing penalties that we can reclaim from the IT contractor, given the IT problems that have been experienced this past year, if I may.
Yes.
And moving quickly to
the list.
Thank you.
Thank you.
To my question, the Cabinet Secretary will be aware that debt in the agricultural sector has increased around 9% over the last year, but there is a worrying trend, I think, over the last 5 to 10 years in the sector. Would the Cabinet Secretary accept that specifically the debt increase this year in the farming community has been, or potentially has been, caused by delayed payments, but in general what his views are on debt in the agricultural industry and how we may look to address that in future?
Well, I think it's a reasonable question, and I think, as with all answers to questions, the thing is to look at the facts. And the most recent facts we have, in terms of figures which were published last Monday, indicate that loans to Scottish agriculture increased 9% to 2.2 billion, up 177 million from the 2.03 billion last year. At the same time, similar figures for loans to the UK, and the categorisation was slightly different, to be accurate about this. Loans to agriculture, hunting and forestry sector, published by the Bank of England, show increases. And moreover, a further important fact to note is that since 2010, lending has increased year on year, both to the UK, agriculture, hunting and forestry sector, lending increased by 51% since 2010, and to the Scottish agriculture sector, without the hunting and the forestry, not sure we have much in the way of hunting, lending increased by 46%. So actually, over the five-year period, according to these statistics from the Bank of England and official statistics, the level of lending increase, and there's no doubt there's been an increase in the level of bank debt, but the level of increase appears to be higher, to have been higher, i.e. 51% increase, in south of the border than north of the border. And, I deal in facts, I deal in evidence. That's the only way a minister can or should make decisions. So looking at the facts, any case that's constructed to demonstrate that the problem is more acute in Scotland, I think kind of falters on the grounds that the facts show that it appears that the level of debt has increased by more south of the border. So I was quite keen to kind of read that into the record because, you know, I wasn't able to do so at the same length in the statement last week, and it was raised then, I think, by colleagues. Of course, you know, we absolutely appreciate the willingness of our banks to lend to farm businesses. And just yesterday, I met with one bank, a meeting with two others this afternoon, and I think the good relationship that exists between banks and the farming sector is an asset. They're tried and trusted relationships. Some other sectors have difficulty in raising access to finance at all. I won't go into that just right now, but I do know that, you know, perhaps the prudent approach that farmers take to managing their finances, and perhaps the fact that there's a substantial security value in the value of most farms, indicates that bankers view farms and farming as a reasonable proposition. But obviously we recognise that any further financial pressures are likely to have some effect here. And that's one of the other reasons why, convener, just to conclude, that, you know, I was pleased that there seemed to be such, in the farming sector, if not perhaps the political world, such a broad-based welcome for the fact that in November we will be injecting a very substantial amount of money into the rural community, up to £300 million. That money will benefit, of course, farmers and crofters. It's their entitlement by way of a loan, and it will also filter down through the whole of the farming world, the contracting sector, the rural community. And I was delighted to see that the Scottish farmer recognises this, the NFU recognise this, various local papers with substantial farming communities recognise this, and I think it will perhaps therefore make a contribution to tackle, in some respects, the matter that has been identified by the member.
Jamie, I'm sure debt in agriculture worries everyone on the committee, but we are quite short of time, so if you're happy, I'd like to move on to the issue of the EU. The Cabinet Secretary would not be surprised that this matter was going to be raised, and I'd like to ask Mike to lead on it, please.
Thank you, Convener.
Speech at 11 o'clock by arrangement, but
I have 3 or 4 minutes on my watch.
Thank you, Convener. With the Common Agricultural Policy, we inherited it when we entered the European Economic Community. It wasn't designed for our agriculture. It was designed initially for French, German, Italian farmers. So we are now leaving the European Union. The UK government has guaranteed Pillar 1 farm payments for the next 4 years. I don't want to discuss what the UK's response is. I would like to discuss what your response is, Minister. We're going to have, because it's entirely devolved to Scotland, this, it is going to be your responsibility. Agriculture is your responsibility in Scotland. And I would like to know, when the 4 years are up, a design of a new system for Scottish agriculture must be a really important issue for you. It must be really almost if not at the top of your agenda, at the near top. So have you set up a system of a team of civil servants in your department looking to design a Scottish system for the system that we go to from 2020? Because, as you know, all funds that come to us come through. Do you not want to answer this question, Minister? All funds come to us from the UK government in the block grant.
I'm very happy to give an answer, Convener, but one, I'm over the time at which we agreed with the clerks, that, and two, this is not an issue about cap payment. I'm very happy to provide an answer, and of course, but it is really a very much political question, I think, and it's really not part of the remit, I would respectfully suggest, of today's inquiry into the cap payment issue.
Cabinet Secretary, I think that there's an issue here that we thought you were leaving at 10:50. That was the information that we've got, and that's the timescale I've been working to. Well, I apologise if for some reason I've had a slight misinformation there.
Well, what I would say is, the question if you want.
If you could, within the timescale, I'd be very
precious. But I mean, he does canvass a lot of areas. I mean, first of all, you know.
Just one. What are you doing about it?
Well, hang on, Mr. Rumbles. There were several questions that you asked there. So, well, which of the several questions is it that you would like me to answer?
Have you
then?
Set up a
team? Hold on, Mike. Sorry, if I can come in, could I simplify it, Cabinet Secretary, and ask you one simple question from what Mike said, is what processes have you put into place now to start looking at what's going to happen post-2020?
Well, we have already had engagement with the sector. I myself led a discussion. Rosanna Cunningham has already led discussion with key stakeholders. All ministers are doing that, and therefore we are preparing in that respect. But it's not just as simple as Mr. Rumbles would have us believe, because, of course, you know, there is absolutely no certainty about what is going to happen following the referendum, because the article hasn't been yet been triggered. Until it is triggered, there is no formal process. I'm no expert in this, but that is my understanding. So there is a total lack of clarity. What I can say is the facts. The facts are that we have sought, and cap payments is a reserved responsibility. Now, the facts are that we've sought, and Mr. Mackay sought from David Gawke, the Treasury minister, that the cap funding will be guaranteed and the SRDP funding will be guaranteed. Thus far, we have received assurances in respect of Pillar 1 up to 220, up to the end of the multi-annual period. And we have already guaranteed that we will pass all of that money on to farmers. The second strand is the SRDP, the Pillar 2 funds. And that, I'm afraid, and this is absolutely essential, because you can't make plans until you know what your budget is going to be in a devolved parliament. We do not know what our budget is going to be, because despite having asked the UK ministers and myself, having written to three of them in June and August, we have not received any confirmation about up to £360 million of SRDP funds. There's a huge shadow hanging over the farming community at the moment. Many of them look to sign up to SRDP, but the only elements of that which have been guaranteed by Mr. Gawke in his letter are those contracts which have been entered into or expect to have been entered into prior to the autumn statement. All of the rest, and our estimate is that it's £360 million, is shrouded in total uncertainty. So I'd put it back to members in this committee. How can a government plan when we do not have clarity of the budget which is set by another body, namely the UK government? Of course, as soon as we get that clarification, then we are able to remove the doubt. And I've spoken to individual farmers about this, and many of the farms that I've visited, they don't know what to do because the UK government, despite the fact that the referendum was several months ago, they haven't got a clue as to whether or not the UK government is guaranteeing the component of the farm payments that would have been guaranteed in continuing membership of the EU up to 220. Certainty has been replaced, by definition, Mr. Rumbles, with total uncertainty.
With respect.
I think that there's two things here. One is there are a couple more questions on the EU, which, given the Cabinet Secretary's time is up, as it were, I'd like to submit. And I'd like to submit your question in a specific form and ask if the Cabinet Secretary would be good enough after the committee to respond to those questions, as he's offered to do to previous questions. But before you go, Cabinet Secretary, could I just ask, is there anything that you'd like to say in summary before you go, bearing in mind you are very short of time?
Well, I'm happy to continue to work with the committee in order to complete the task of getting the cap payments onto a proper footing. I'm very pleased that we've made substantial progress, and the national loan scheme that we brought forward seems to have been welcomed by the farming community. And I hope this committee in its deliberations will be able to conclude that that loan scheme is a pragmatic measure which provides, as I think a Conservative member mentioned last week, certainty and clarity for the rural communities in the winter months coming.
Cabinet Secretary, I'd like to thank you and your team, Jonathan, David, for coming and giving evidence to the committee. I think that the committee would ask me just to put on record that we'd look forward to having an opportunity to question you further in January, as you've said that is approximately the timescale when you'll be in a position to come back to Parliament and brief them on the payment situation. I'd also like to place on record that I look forward to having an opportunity to discuss matters with you in ways that the committee can help take business forward for farming in Scotland. So thank you very much for your time and your honesty. I'm going to, just suspend the meeting to allow the Cabinet Secretary and his team to depart and for those members of the committee to refresh themselves before we go on to the next subject, which is of equal importance. delay. I think that there is a queuing system in operation, but normal business will be resumed shortly. And the fourth item on the agenda today is to take evidence from the ScotRail Alliance. Following the Infrastructure and Capital Investment Committee's inquiry into access to Scotland's major railway stations in session four, Phil Verster, the Managing Director of the ScotRail Alliance, committed to providing regular updates on the rail network and service issues to the predecessor committee. The committee has agreed that it would be very helpful to continue these sessions, and I'd like to welcome him and Carl Budge, who is the Regional Director of the Infrastructure Projects, SNE and Network Rail. And I would like to ask Mr. Verster if he'd like to make an opening statement.
Yes, thank you very much, Convener, for the opportunity to be here today. I'm very keen to share with the committee the very exciting future that we have for Scotland's railway over the next 3 years. During the next 3 years, there are four big changes in Scotland's railway, which has a very big impact on our customer satisfaction, the capacity and the size of the railway. The first of these are infrastructure programs and projects, such as Egypt, such as Aberdeen to Inverness, programs that will contribute significantly to how the railway operates. And if I give you a sense of the capacity increase that would be possible after that, we'd have Aberdeen to Inverness capacity and daily seats would increase by around 75%. If you think of the Central Belt, we will have seat capacity which is increased by around 51%. On Borders, 33% more capacity. And Aberdeen to the Central Belt would be 66% more, and Inverness to the Central Belt would have 43% more capacity. These are huge capacity increases. And then secondly, we are changing the fleet size in Scotland from around 800 vehicles to 1,000 vehicles. And that increase of nearly 200 vehicles makes a massive difference to our ability to improve our performance on our railway, because congested trains run slower, it's more difficult to keep to time. And that capacity that we get from extra rolling stock will allow us to solve many of the complaints that we get from our customers in terms of capacity. The third big change is we're changing the products we offer our Scottish customers. So implementing an intercity railway between the seven cities of Scotland is a fantastic change, and it will replace the old commuter-type rolling stock that is currently working the services between places such as Aberdeen, Inverness, and the Central Belt. And the last and fourth change, which is fantastic for us, is we as a company are investing significantly in our employees, in investment, in behaviors, in customer experience, and customer focus programs. And over the next 3 years, we see a change in terms of how we serve our customers, as well as how customers buy tickets. One of our very exciting programs is our Smart Card program, which by 2019, March, we expect about 60% of our ticket sales to be through smart cards rather than the old paper-based tickets. All of these changes will amount to a significantly different railway and a very positive change for Scotland's railway. And if I can close, Convener, just to say thank you for the opportunity to be here today, and I'll continue to support the committee, and very welcome, very keen to attend further sessions in the future after today's session, and to continue to give you an update on what we do on Scotland's railway. Thank you very much.
Okay, I'd like to thank you for that opening statement. And before we actually go to asking questions, I would just like to ask any of the members present whether they have any declarations of interest that they'd like to make. I see three of us, four of us. So starting, John, would you like to?
Well, I don't know if I really need to declare this, but I chair the cross-party group on rail in the Parliament.
Okay. Stuart?
I'm Honorary President of the Scottish Association for Public Transport and Honorary Vice President of Rail Future UK.
Gail?
I am joint vice president of Friends of the Far North Line.
Gosh, they're all coming out. John.
I'm a member of the Parliament's RMT group.
Okay. Sorry, gosh, it's never ending. It's
good. You'd seen me indicate before. Right. I am joint vice president along with Gail of Friends of the Far North Line.
Anyone else? Well, I'll declare an interest in that the Aberdeen-Inverness line goes through my farm. So that's my interest. It's a very small farm, 500 acres, but I just happen to have a railway in the middle of it. So I'd like to move on, if I may. And the first question that really we have is to do with project management. And I think Stuart is going to lead on that. Sorry?
Well, we're going to say something about the Alliance first.
The
Alliance.
Questions about how the Alliance works?
Oh, yes. Yeah. Sorry. Yes, John. Sorry.
Yeah, it was an extra one to start off with because, I mean, we are going to be covering a lot of ground today, but I just wondered if you could say, as by way of introduction, something about how the ScotRail Alliance works with Network Rail, because in the past we thought you were ScotRail and somebody else was Network Rail, but now you represent both. Could you just explain a little bit how that works? And there's obviously other people using the rail, like, say, cross country, who are not part of that, and how it affects them.
So in the last 2 or 3 years, Network Rail has devolved responsibility for operations, maintenance, and renewals, therefore not enhancement projects, to what's called routes. And in Scotland, there's a Scotland route that does the operation, maintenance, and renewals. And to picture it, these are the teams, and they work for me, that on a daily basis make sure that all of the infrastructure equipment out there, tunnels, bridges, everything, signaling is maintained, that it's renewed on an ongoing basis, so when it gets to end of life, gets fixed, and that the railway is operated in the interest of all of the train operators that operate in Scotland. So I have that accountability in the Scotland route. Then, sitting right next to it, we have Abellio ScotRail as the franchise that was let by the Scottish Government. Throughout the United Kingdom, these two parts of the railway have been separated as different entities. And in Scotland, and Scotland alone, we have formed what's called the ScotRail Alliance. The logic behind that is that in the end, the customer on the ground don't really want to know how the railway has decided to organize itself. The customer on the ground has very clear requirements to get journeys, travel punctually, and get a good service. And we've put the two, in Scotland, we have put these two organizations together to work together and to close those gaps which existed between these two companies in the past and to get a better product out for customers. And I'm sure we're going to spend a lot of time today to talk about that. But just as a distinction then, Carl over here on my right-hand side is a close colleague. Carl is the regional director of a part of Network Rail which is not part of our alliance. And that part of Network Rail is called Network Rail Infrastructure Projects. Carl heads up the operations in Scotland as well as the operations in the northeast of the United Kingdom from York for those types of operations. However, Carl contributes very closely to Scotland. And my team holds the clienting responsibility. Therefore, everything Carl delivers, my team makes sure that that is delivered to TS's requirements. And so if there's any difficulty with scope or program or on-program delivery, which is all Carl's accountability, we work together with Carl and with Transport Scotland to come up with the right answer for Scotland. And just on your question on other train operators, I hold, and I this week held the regular review with other operators as well, because yes, there's a different dimension here. There are six different train operators that operate into Scotland on a regular basis, including Caledonian Sleeper and the two Virgin trains, East Coast, West Coast, Cross Country, First Transpennine Express. And so it's really important that that we, even though we're an alliance, ScotRail and Network Rail operations, maintenance and renewals, we must also have that breadth of approach to deal with the issues of other train operators specifically. If you have a very quick example, when Lamington on the West Coast had the scour problem last year due to the excessively high water levels in the Clyde, I took my ScotRail trains off the Glasgow and South Western Railway, and we ran Virgin trains, West Coast trains, and we cancelled our service to run that, because even though if it was wrong, I would have had a proprietary approach and said, no, our trains run. We made the decision about what's best for Scotland, and that's why Virgin Trains got the clear path. We cancelled our services to accommodate Virgin Trains. And that's a type of approach that we follow. And we regularly review with other train operators how we are servicing their requirements. So it is a unique model in the UK. It's very innovative, and we are aiming to focus on our customers as best we can.
So that's very helpful. Thank you.
Do you want to follow that up?
Yep.
Stuart, do you want to ask a question then on project?
Yes, sorry.
Yes, thanks very much. Thanks for your various reports, Mr. Vester. I'm wondering then, on a very specific, you would imagine Abellio would be hoped to get some sort of advantage out of that, the nature of that relationship, this deep alliance. If, for instance, there, all things being equal, there was the opportunity for a commuter train from Perth to travel to Ladybank, or a delayed sleeper to travel north from Ladybank to Perth on that single stretch, who would have priority there?
Very good question, Mr. Finney. What we have in our control centre is a very clear definition of what we call regulation priorities. Regulation is a type of decision we make when two trains get to a junction, and we put a choice, and we agree a choice with the train operators of which train is the most important to run. Your Ladybank example is really spot on, actually, because when we had a diversion of Caledonian sleeper trains during the Winchbury tunnel blockade, we had to make choices when the Caledonian sleeper train got to its slot too late. And if we then let the Caledonian sleeper train run, we were in a situation very often where we would affect four or five services through five. So we made arrangements with the Caledonian sleeper to make sure that they get there early so they can use their slot. So very clear sets of rules, no judgment of, no, that's our train, we can go first. Clear choices, clear decisions about how we do what's called regulation choices, and it's agreed with the train operators. So we try not to leave that to chance.
And if I may convene, you didn't mention the freight companies, the goods freight companies. Where do they fit in this? Because, again, due to the limitations of a lot of the line structure, there's a lot of, as you say, one delay can result in several knock-ons.
Yes. In terms of our cross-team collaboration with other train operators, freight operators are included in that discussion. We have a separate freight forum that meets regularly with my own team, separate to the train operating companies. And the issues with freight are very different to those of train companies. But freight is as important, if not in some market sectors, more important. And so we've got a dedicated person that develops freight opportunities and work very closely with the freight companies. And when you look at freight companies and the type of performance choice that you refer to at Ladybank Junction, any other junctions that are more freight-oriented, freight very often don't run to the same time constraints that passenger services run to. So in that same regulation statement that I've just mentioned to you in your example of Caledonian Sleeper relative to Abellio ScotRail trains, we'll also have freight companies listed on there. And by industry agreement, freight companies are very often at the bottom of the list of regulation choices, because the time criticality on passenger services for punctuality is 5 minutes at end destination, while for freight companies, it is flexible.
Thank you, that's very helpful.
Thank you. Okay, Stuart.
Thank you very much, convener. And
essentially, I'm focusing on Network Rail's management of project. The Scottish Government, in the light of what's happening in Egypt in particular, has commissioned a study into project management. And I know that Network Rail have experienced a number of issues, GB-wide in particular, that is of interest in some ways to us. The Great Western Railway electrification project is well known to be in some serious difficulties. How are you in relation to what's happening in Scotland, which is primarily Egypt, but there are other projects, seeking to address issues with project management?
Thank you. Thank you, Convener, for the opportunity to be here today and speak to the committee. As you say, we do have a number of national issues. These were realised probably 4 or 5 years ago, mainly in a couple of categories, which was that we were quite late, I think, as an industry in developing the current enhancements work bank, and therefore to actually be able to clearly define what the scope was that met the required outputs that we were given, the outputs being time savings or capacity increases and so on and so forth. It was acknowledged that the costs that were given at back in, say, 2013, 2014, were not fully developed to meet the required scope and outputs. So it was accepted that as an industry answer to that issue, a process was put together called the Enhancements Cost Adjustment Mechanism, which allows us to take what the initial business plan was, the Office of Road and Rail, then at an appropriate point in time when the scope has been developed through to a single option, and we understand some of the ground investigation, some of the more detailed issues, that we will then agree what is an efficient cost to deliver that project. So that is carrying on each project as we work through the current five-year control period, which is 2014 through to 2019. So that's the first point. I think the second thing that we realised is that instead of actually just giving a single figure at the beginning of this control period, we should probably have given a range of figures for what projects could cost, instead of actually defining something that none of us were really certain about at the time. There have been several reports done in Great Britain over the last couple of years. Sir Peter Hendy did a report, and there's also been the Bow report and the Shaw report. The Bow report is specifically about those issues that I've just talked about on cost and scope. Some of the further issues as we came into the current control period, and the one bespoke feature about this control period is there's about a tenfold increase in the amount of electrification going on compared with what happened previously to what's happening now. That's a massive leap in electrification, and also ties in all of the design and specification increases which have come out in modern electrification as well, because we've significantly modernised the way we electrify the railway. So there's a significant piece in there. That was accepted by the Network Rail Board in early 2015, and we set up something called the Enhancements Improvement Plan, which focuses on several key elements, seven key elements that we need to do better in future. We're working through those seven key elements at the moment. How those elements, three specifically of that plan, are being ingrained in Scotland is a review that the Office of Road and Rail are undertaking at the moment. And I think they're due to report back to Transport Scotland at the end of October 2016. Those three specific pieces they're looking at are really about portfolio governance, and that is partly about the relationship between my own team, Phil's team, through to Transport Scotland and through to the Office of Rail and Rail, partly at specific project governance and how we carry out reporting, and also project and portfolio monitoring and how we pull all of the enhancement projects together so people have a visibility of the entire portfolio within Scotland at a single time. So that report is going on at the moment. I can talk in detail about each one of those and a whole load of other things, but I'm will let you advise me if you'd like me to go into much deeper detail.
Do forgive me if I suggest that sounds a bit like jam tomorrow when we've got projects that are in course right now. The Shaw report, I think, seems to be considerable doubt as to what parts of that will or will not be implemented, and that's definitely a jam tomorrow, if it's anything. Can I just ask you, is part, the one thing you didn't mention was access to skills that are required for particular projects. For example, there are shortages in signalling engineers. Europe-wide, there are shortages in engineers that can do the overhead electrifications. How does that influence and feed into the projects that you're undertaking?
If I could respond and just respond to the first aspect, just of the Bow Review and the improvements in project management, Mr. Stevenson, that you referred to. So what's really clear, just unambiguously clear, is that that what we used in the UK industry, UK industry-wide, throughout Network Rail, to price and estimate schemes and infrastructure projects during the period for 2015 to 2019 was done at too early a stage. It was done very often with desktop exercises, best estimates, but not with enough detail. And what we are seeing now is that when we get on the ground and detailed designs are getting done, the cost of the work is significantly more because things arise. Ground tests are done, and all of a sudden, where you thought you're going to do track just like this, you need to do it in 10 different ways and much more of it. So, and we will talk about that as we get to that. On your project management question and your skills question, in Carl's team, and Carl will talk about that as the question on Egypt comes up, we have seen a significant limit on resources in electrification specialities. But what we've done on project management has been extensive. We've put better project management, a project management office in place, more transparent procedures in place. When we realized around January, February, that electrification on the Egypt program was behind program, we've changed the senior management on that project very significantly. And we made intrusive changes in terms of how that team works, not only relative to the ScotRail Alliance, but also relative to Transport Scotland. And Carl will talk you through that detail very, very specifically. In terms of electrification projects, your comment on scarce resources is really on the mark. We see that design bottleneck of resources, skills resources in the United Kingdom to follow through on designs is very, very significant. And many parts of our electrification project now is about making sure that we get access to the right competencies at the right time.
I just make the observation I had agreed with Andrew Adonis when I was Transport Minister, a sort of 10-year view on how we'd do electrification so that we'd give the industry a solid programme they could ramp up to. It probably hasn't happened, but don't comment on that, we don't have time. My final point on projects, particularly given your Dutch experience, recognising that you don't have many bridges and cuttings in the Netherlands, nonetheless, there is a startling difference in the cost of doing projects in GB and in Scotland in particular, compared with most of Europe and perhaps in particular the Netherlands. Why is that the case? Can't we learn something more of how we manage projects and deliver projects from our continental cousins?
That's a very, very astute observation, Mr. Stevenson. We do go out and look at how other countries in Europe operate, how they make decisions, how they get critical aspect, how they get access secured with the train operators. In many cases, the separation between track and train operator is not the same as in the UK, and the cost equation to get access to the railway is different. Your point is still valid. What we are doing now, and in terms of our cost increases on electrification, again, Carl would pick up on what has been done to get our standards to be compliant with European standards, and that has contributed to cost increases across our electrification program.
If I could just add a little bit further to that answer as well, specifically to Holland, for example, it's not unusual from an access regime when you're delivering a significant enhancement to close the railway for several weeks, and that can be an acceptance, and I have reports which I can send you which would help back that up if needs be. So they can close it, so there can be a specifically different access regime at the night. So if you look at elements of Egypt we're working on at the moment, we get circa 1.5 hours of good working time per night. By the time the final train is gone, we've been able to start the possession, briefed everybody and got them on site, 1.5 hours of working, then you're taking them off. That, unfortunately, is never going to be a really efficient way to do work, a significant amount of works on a railway, but that's the regime that we work in.
Closing railways down, and not one that we'd necessarily be recommending here. But can I just push you a wee bit on this project management so I understand it? Project management is good when there's scrutiny downwards as well as upwards and from higher up. Could you just explain to me what level of scrutiny the government does in relation to projects and how regular your meetings are with them in relation to projects? Because I was rather surprised to see a quote from our Minister of Transport suggesting that he wasn't aware of a delay that was coming down the track, if you'll excuse the pun.
So if I can respond to that, we have formed with Transport Scotland a portfolio board. Even before the portfolio board, we have had with Transport Scotland a regular Egypt board to review progress. In the portfolio board with Transport Scotland, we review what the programme and AFC or full cost estimates are for the different programmes. We work very closely with Transport Scotland, and Transport Scotland has a very strong and positive role that they play in helping us to understand what the priorities are for the Scottish Government. So in terms of our own governance procedures, we have literally levels and layers of governance where Carl and his team give myself and my team visibility of where they are with their program deliveries. Then we'll have, and Carl will have with his own electrification team that delivers, his contractors that work in an alliance with him and his team, that have an alliance board meeting where they track how that program is running. And then right at the front of the business, there are weekly, what we call visualization rooms or control rooms, where governance is exercised on what has been the progress this week, what's been the progress last night. And that level of control is part of our corrective actions that we've implemented from January and February this year.
Okay, so I mean, what I'm trying just to get my thought process around is when the Minister of Transport made a statement on the 5th of July that he said that 2 months ago everything was on programme as far as the Egypt project was concerned, and then it's 7 months late. So was there a meeting 2 months? When was the meeting, the last meeting before the 5th of July with the portfolio board that informed Transport Scotland on this project?
So, thank you very much, Convener. I don't have the exact meeting dates here, but what I can provide the committee with is when meeting dates happened as a further correspondence with this committee year after. What I can indicate, which may help and which would clarify the comments that you refer to, is in January, the Egypt team, the then Egypt team that manages the leadership of the then Egypt team that managed the Egypt electrification program started to indicate to me that there were delays, quote unquote, that had to be quantified and clarified, but that the initial estimate was that delays were in the region of 8 weeks. So we started immediately with a program to establish exactly what the delay is. I insisted that there's a review, that there's a critical path analysis of where the programme is, that there's a resource assessment and a risk assessment of what's the remaining risk on that programme. So that process to clarify exactly where the programme was, what work has been done, what work is outstanding, started to elevate quite a lot of the issues we have seen and that we have rectified later on. We informed Transport Scotland, typically if it was in February, I think it was the 11th or the 15th of February, I'll confirm that date with you as well, that there were delays in the ballpark of 8 weeks that were being investigated. So at the time, we could not put a price on what the scope of the work was or what the cost of the work was. The 8 week delay was still such that it would have enabled key output one in December of this year to have been achieved. So while the delays were then visible in January and February, it was anticipated that we could still deliver the program. And we responded as a ScotRail Alliance by changing when we train drivers to make sure we can still hit an energization date. And as an industry, we thought we came up with something that was a real workable solution. However, as we kept on digging and finding problems on this program, and Carl joined during that stage as leadership changes happened on that side of the business, we found more issues. And in the end, the program that we then advised the minister on come March, April, very close to the date you are talking about, that program looked very different to the one we thought in February would be achievable. And we started to share what we thought the cost estimates were, because by then we had costed up what this change in compliance, which is an adherence of a European standard that we insisted the project must achieve, what that would cost.
And I appreciate that you'll give me the committee those dates afterwards. What's concerning me is that we move from February, where there's a 7 or 8 week delay, which I think you intimated there, to May, which is when the minister tells us it had gone to 7 months, and nothing really was in the public domain to that. So maybe it would just be helpful to leave that there and ask for the dates. And a timeline so we can understand that as a committee. And maybe then if I could turn to, was it you, John, on because I think you want to go specifically onto this issue of Egypt.
Well, we have, I mean, spoken quite a bit already about Egypt, but just maybe a few more points on that. I mean, I suppose what surprised me and disappointed me was that other projects had gone fantastically well. I mean, Airdrie Bathgate, New Line, electrified, I think went to time, went to budget. The borders, same, it wasn't electrified. And then even the Queen Street Tunnel closure, which I accept is a separate project, seemed to go very smoothly. And so it was a bit of a surprise that Egypt, Edinburgh Glasgow Improvement Programme, didn't. I mean, the ORR have made various comments, and I think one of the things they raised was the whole question of international engineering specifications and electricity at work regulations. Can you just explain, were they major factors, or was that a major part of it? Yes.
And we'd really like to explain that. So if I can just start by putting our delivery in Scotland in perspective, because our delivery and Carl's team's delivery in Scotland, despite the difficulties we are facing now, has been exemplary. We've got 16 regulated targets, milestones, during this control period from 2014 to 2019. We've already delivered 10 to time. There's a further 4 that's in progress to be delivered on time. And then there are 2, which is the key output one we're talking about now, and potentially the key output 3 for the completion of the Queen Street refurbishment, which may be affected by the current TORS Transport and Works Act program that we are working through. So the delivery has been good. But the compliance part of this international specification electrification has added critical cost and time to our program. And Carl will explain how we had originally in the program a national network rail standard that we thought could be delivered And that we were risk assessing that and how the risk assessments have led us to a decision to adopt the European standard.
Yeah, thank you, Phil. So the electrification compliance piece is really quite complex, but I'll try and keep it as simple as I can do for the purpose of today. There are multiple bits of legislation that tie into it. Some is UK legislation, some is European legislation, some are UK rail standards, and then Network Rail has its own further set of standards and advice notes as well. So it's an element of being a minefield within there. A lot of those standards also allow for interpretation and risk assessment as to what is an acceptable level of achievement against those standards as well. So interpretation comes into it. The interpretation between ourselves and the Office of Road and Rail hasn't always been the same, partly because we have a historic way of managing electrification on the network, which doesn't necessarily always tie in with some of the new requirements coming in. So there's a transitional piece. If I look specifically at some of the compliance issues that we've had, in early 2015, there was an energy TSI, which stands for Technical Specification for Interoperability, which is a European standard which was updated, which changed the distance away from the wires that was considered to be safe for bridges or for railway platforms, for example. So that actually brought into being design changes and redesign of some of the wire heights on some of the obstructions that we'd got on the Egypt line. Now that doesn't...
were presumably stricter and were wanting a greater distance these cases.
That's
yeah, right. Okay. That's
yeah.
Fine.
So a distance from a platform, for example, for the wire height, the minimum distance used to be 2.75 meters from the edge of a platform, went to 3.5 meters. The distance from a bridge to the wires went from something like 270 millimeters to 350 millimeters. So that doesn't mean it was a complete rewire of Egypt and that everything had been put up, which is what the media suggested several weeks ago. What it meant was redesign in certain areas and very localized changes to certainly around structures where we had to change the wire height slightly or risk assess through to prove that we didn't need to. So that was an ongoing process that started in 2015. Along a project the length of Egypt and with as many structures as it has, it's been really quite complex to do that. And each one of those risk assessments needs obviously signing off and agreeing in turn. That's one example. It's also impacted things like boundary wall measures. So we're having to do thousands of meters more fencing than was originally considered. Parapet heights. So I can pass around some photos, but a typical parapet on a bridge would have been up to about this level, and then we have to go and put two extra levels of layers of brickwork on top, then a very significant copa on top. So that's on probably 140, 150 parapets over the railway line.
And if for your own reference, all of the other older electrification schemes, such as the East Coast Main Line, West Coast Main Line, wouldn't have had those restrictions on them. So they'll be on the old specification, and they are... No, they don't have to go back and change that at all.
No.
So there was this attempt by Network Rail to keep costs down and say, well, this new specification is really high. Can we risk assess it so that we get a derogation and therefore not have to comply?
Right.
So we made a decision last year when all of the shenanigans started to become really clear about the cost issues. It became also clear to us and to me that if we don't comply with these standards, the ORR will not sign off that this line goes live. So we can continue to have the debate, and it gets so late in the program that you then build a railway and the OR says you can't run anything on it. So I made the decision in around March period of time and asked the project team, and it was just before Carl joined, said, stop the debate, move to the new standard. The railway needs to be, but the railway has a life of hundreds of years into the future. Fix this now.
How much notice do you get
and they're bringing in a new rule like that, how long do you have to, you know, adapt to it and prepare for it?
I dare say it's reasonable notice. And I dare say, therefore, in full transparency, the debate on risk assessments and what standards to use went on for too long. We had to call time on it, and we did that in 2015.
I just need to be absolutely clear with you that that specific compliance issue relates to an energy standard update in 2015, that there were other standards, European ones, that came to being in 2011, which Network Rail continued to debate with the Office and Radar Rail for several years, and we didn't react to immediately, and that is something that we could potentially have done faster in hindsight.
So like the 2011 rules were there, but you were still discussing how they needed to be applied.
And whether the hierarchy of standards that we'd got in the UK actually came over the European standard.
Right.
So the whole standards debate is extremely
complex. That's helpful.
Complex.
I mean, we probably don't want to go on forever on this particular thing. Could I just ask two more things on this? Sorry, yes, okay.
What's really important to understand here, though, is, and for the committee's benefit, and I know it's unpalatable and it's a difficult message, quite a lot of the cost movements, and the ORR references that in their submission to this meeting as well, around 50% of the cost movement on electrification, rolling electrification programs, are due to this type of compliance issue. The railway is, this is not money wasted. The railway is getting a different specification. So it's work that has to be done. It has a program impact, yes, and we're doing everything, working very closely, very, very collaboratively with Transport Scotland and the supply chain to deliver it. But it's not money wasted. It's delivering a scope which is different to what was envisaged at the time when the programs were costed and estimated 2012, 2013. Lucky
that with this project the new rules came in at the time, whereas say take something like Airdrie Bathgate, we were lucky that the rules didn't change at the time.
Gradually over time the ORR has insisted that compliance levels be increased to these standards. So yes, that is one of the big differences in cost drivers between Airdrie Bathgate and where we are today.
Okay, so just two more things I want. First of all, so going forward, we've looked at the past. How are we for timetable going forward on EGIP, and what about costs?
So in terms of costs, we have made a submission to Transport Scotland of what we estimate the cost increases will be, as well as what the programme will be. Transport Scotland is busy with their own review, supported by Ernst & Young, and it's the intention of Transport Scotland to declare the outcome of that review and the cost increases across the different programmes when that review is complete. Clearly, the cost that Network Rail submits into Transport Scotland is only a part of the overall cost picture. So Transport Scotland will declare what the full impact on EGIP is, around, I think it's the end of October. And it'll be useful for us to for us or Transport Scotland to share that with the committee afterwards. What is the timeline to declare those costs and to identify what those costs are?
Some of the costs in October. When are the electric trains going to be running on the line?
So, while key output one was for electrification by December, the first electric trains, the class 385s, the new electric trains that gets delivered, arrives in September of next year. And so the current program that Carl and his team is working on is for completion in July. And we're doing quite a lot of work to try and better that and improve that and to turn that situation into a success. And maybe when we get to a future meeting, we will update you on that. So we are still, even though the key output one has moved to July, it is still in time that to accommodate new trains, and the customer impact is therefore negligible. However, we would have wanted to have had electrification as soon as possible.
Okay, thanks. And my final point then, I mean, as part of this or as a separate project, Queen Street Tunnel was closed, and as far as I'm aware, that went very smoothly, and people were pretty happy with it.
It did.
And you did close the line, and we survived, so that was great. Somewhat to my surprise, though, when you reintroduced the timetable, it was a different timetable on other lines, especially the Airdrie Bathgate line, and that has resulted in a cut in service to people, particularly in the east end of Glasgow. I mean, can you explain how that happened and there was no local consultation?
So definitely, and there was extensive consultation, and the consultation around what the post-Queen Street timetable would look like was conducted at the time when we consulted out the timetable for the Queen Street blockade itself. So what we have had post-Queen Street as a timetable has been what we call a clock face timetable, which is broadly a train. If a train runs every quarter of an hour, they run exactly quarter of an hour apart. And by running quarter of an hour apart, it gives customers a higher degree of certainty that they don't have three trains in the hour, two of them are bunched up in the first quarter of an hour and the other one sits somewhere else, so they know exactly when trains run. And at the same time, in terms of the comment you make, Mr. Mason, on capacity, by having a clock face timetable, we have been able to strengthen more trains than what we have done in the past. So we have also a real opportunity from the North Lanarkshire area of the country to the West Lothian area of the country to exploit untapped latent demand. Now, travel opportunities which we have not maximized with previous timetables. So one of the things we have suggested is to apply this quarterly, so for four trains in an hour, train every quarter, and this clock face timetable through post the Queen Street blockade.
But a station like Shettleston used to have four trains an hour to Edinburgh, and now it only has two. So you do accept that's a cut in service.
So I have to come back to you on Shettleston, because I don't think it's two. I think it had two fast trains and it had two slower trains, which were stoppers. And what we have done is we've changed the fast train, we have changed the two fast trains to be two slower trains, therefore more multiple stops. And by doing that, we've actually given, we've given our customers along that whole route a better service in terms of stopping pattern without reducing journey time too significantly. The original timetable had this idea of fast trains running through from Glasgow through to Edinburgh. By having a different stopping pattern, we've added something like 2 minutes to those trains. I'll come back to you on Shettleston specifically.
Yep.
I'll come back to Shettleston specifically.
Thanks, Chair. I think I've had my shot. Yes.
You are running short, because Rhoda would like to come in on this project as well.
Just a very short question, because I think a lot of questions have been answered. Just going back to the specification, given that that specification was in place a long time ago, who was responsible for implementing it as part of the design? Was it Transport Scotland, yourselves? Was it the contractor? Who's at fault here for not implementing the specifications?
Mrs. Grant, could you please clarify which specification that's for Egypt?
Yes.
So the Transport Scotland and a pass to us, we deliver those outputs. So we build up the final specification along with our route colleagues in Phil's team. And then delivering to that specification is absolutely my accountability. What I would take you back to, though, is the change. That specification has been changed as the compliance piece has developed over the last 3 or 4 years, so that has brought a number of changes in that specification. Each time one of those compliance elements changes, we change the specification effectively for what we are building. So that is why we have to remain relatively agile from a design perspective.
The decision on how to implement something, the specification, resides with Network Rail. What Transport Scotland, as the client, does quite correctly is they would specify an output. So for example, very often Transport Scotland would say, if I take Aberdeen to Inverness, to say there's a requirement to run an hourly service or an half hourly service. They don't specify, go and fix this bridge over there and put double track over there and do that.
So Network Rail's responsibility of getting the project design correct.
That's right.
Yes.
OK. Okay, but you're going back to Transport Scotland for more money because you got it wrong.
That's correct.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Can we move on from that particular project? Mike's got a question on the Aberdeen to Inverness line.
Yes, indeed. Thank you very much, Convener. Oh, I was just thinking there, train services every quarter of an hour. That would be marvellous. That would be marvellous.
Very unlikely.
So, Aberdeen to Inverness. The Office of Rail and Road indicates in written evidence to the committee that is currently reviewing the Aberdeen-Inverness project and the elements of the project, and it was quite alarming when it said it, may be delayed by some years. So I was really, I'm concerned about this. Can you give me an update as to, from your perspective, what's happening on the Aberdeen-Inverness line and what does it mean by some years?
Yes, I can give an update, Mr. Rumbles, and if I give you honestly a view that says there isn't a better example of where the previous estimation stroke pricing regime has not worked, it is Aberdeen to Inverness. And if I give you, which is what was covered with a Bow review and was found to be the endemic problem throughout of the United Kingdom. I'll give you two practical examples. So on Aberdeen to Inverness, as I've listed to you previously, the aspirations for capacity increase there and what we will deliver with Aberdeen to Inverness program is a 75% increase in seat capacity on a weekday. And even though you've said every quarter of an hour is an attractive service, you will get every half hour service, which is fantastic for that part of our network. I'm very excited about that. But let me give you the two examples. So what has happened here is that the initial exercise to determine what Aberdeen to Inverness should look like as a future railway was very much a strategic and planning process, which was a desktop exercise without enough detailed development. I'll be really clear, even with our revised program, we're not declaring it'll be years late. That's not on the cards. What we are declaring is that it may be completed in two phases. And as you probably know, we've spent nearly £30 million already on the initial work at Elgin and Forres. Coming to the two examples. Elgin to Inverness, for example, to deal with a half-hourly service, needed capacity changes. So if we were to deliver just what was originally envisaged, we probably would have had to come back in 5-10 years' time, close the line again, and do more work on it. Understanding what in detail what had to be done on the ground when it got to the detailed design over the last year, the teams identified that now is the right time to go and put in things like turn back facilities for trains to turn around, more sidings and different signaling. So that was not envisaged originally, but is implemented now to give the capacity that's useful for the future development of that line. So go in once, spend the cost once and get it done once. So this is cost that would have been incurred somewhere in the future to add the capacity we're incurring now. So the whole phasing of how Aberdeen to Inverness over the next 10 or 15 years would have grown and developed has been affected by this decision in terms of how we now plan to do the Elgin to Inverness end. If I give you a second example, between Inverurie and Aberdeen, it was previously double-tracked. And so the desktop exercise assumed, well, it was previously double-tracked, we're going to double-track again, so we'll only renew 4 miles of track, and double-tracking will just put it in there. But when ground studies were done, and when people started to actually get into the nitty-gritty to see what the detail on the ground was, which is the big change from the what we've done in CP, the previous control period up to 2019, and which we'll do differently in the future, it was found that we had to do extensive earthworks to actually support the new double tracking, and that those earthworks would be necessary to avoid having to procure land on the side of the railway. So it is a cost balance. But also, the team then said, well, if you have to move the track in order to get everything to where it needs to be, the track will have to renew a further 11 miles of track in order to deliver the railway as we want it. So again, if I just explain how this works, that track would have been renewed, say, somewhere in the future, 7-10 years from now.
So cost we would have incurred in the future, we've now pulled forward to get this program to give us the best possible railway when we commission it. So those things are examples of scope changes that if you do not work out the detail up front to the level that you can actually pinpoint the cost better, it comes back and it looks like big numbers after the event. However, again, as with other cases, the railway is getting more because more is getting done to get the railway in place. This is not wastage or cost. This is about more capacity that's added and how it's done.
Could I just ask you, therefore?
Please.
When the residents in my area of Aberdeenshire, for instance, on that line, when can they expect a half-hour service from that train line?
December 2019.
They'll get it in
December 2019.
You're fairly confident about that.
Yeah, I am. I am, because we... Look, forgive me for just saying it like this. I know how committees like this feel when you see witnesses. I'm passionate about our railway, and so is Carl. And we want to deliver the right thing, and we are just focused to get our estimates right and to get the job delivered right. And the plans we've put in to Transport Scotland is aiming for December 2019.
Can I just add 2 points to that as well, if I can do? Firstly, the team that we've got working on Aberdeen to Inverness are the same ones who delivered Borders, same ones who delivered Airdrie to Bathgate. They're an excellent team. So they don't just become bad overnight. So great people on it. And secondly, one of the regulatory milestones that we have already passed in this control period was dated July 2016, so a couple of months ago, which was to pass the single option development on Aberdeen to Inverness. We hit that milestone. So from my perspective, as of today, we are actually on programme as was anticipated 3 years ago. What then has changed is the scope has grown, which is what pushes it into the beginning of the next control period.
Can I just to clarify something there, just so I understand, in December 2019, when I think you said that we on the line would have a train every half an hour, is that a train between Aberdeen and Inverness, or is it on a shorter route? I want to be exactly clear, so when we meet again in 2019, to understand what we're holding you to account for.
So there's a number of phases of what we deliver and when timetable changes will be implemented. So we implement timetable changes regularly in December of every year and May of every year. So what I will supply the committee with is our forecast and our position on what will happen in each of the timetable changes on that line from now to December 19.
Right. I look forward to seeing those timetables. And Mike, are you happy that we leave that there? Because there is a huge amount to cover.
Yeah.
And I know Stuart just wants to ask a quick question on electrification.
Yes.
We've covered it.
Save it for steam.
Don't worry.
Later. Sorry, Richard.
Thank you. Mr. Budge, I now know why you're raising the bridges on the M74. Thank you very much for that information. And also, can I say that my mother-in-law was Dutch, and I travelled on quite a lot of trains in Holland. And thank you, for allowing us to, John Mason and I, to walk through the new Queen Street Tunnel. Before it was opened, that was an interesting day. But can I turn to the Office of Rail and Road have identified their issues with the rolling programme of electrification, especially on the Shorts and Dunblane lines, particularly the underestimation of what's required to deliver the project. Now that this has happened, what are you doing to rectify these problems, prevent them from recurring in the future? And could you also tell me, will the closure of the bridge at Clelland Station, over Clelland, the railway at Clelland, have any effect on timetables?
Sorry, can I just come in here and just say that there's a huge amount on the agenda, and that was an extremely long question, very detailed as always. Could I implore you to keep your answers as short as possible? And could I just ask members of the committee always to keep their questions as short as possible? It's a very reasonable question. Looking at no one in particular, but we have a lot to cover between now and 12:30. Sorry, yes.
Okay, thank you. So, firstly, many of the electrification issues on shots and the other projects that we're delivering at the moment come back to the compliance issue again, unfortunately, which I think we've probably covered enough here. That are changes that I'm making anyway since I've come in, and I'd take the point of Mr. Stevenson with regards to enhancements improvement is jammed tomorrow, so we have to do things immediately to try and get hold of some of the things we're doing. One of the things that I've done is restructured the Scotland team, so we have a specific programme management organisation that sits above all of the electrification schemes and also gives a single engineering team that sits beneath it instead of siloed engineering teams sitting on each. That means that as we get the compliance learning on key output one, for example, it's passed on to Shotts, passed on to Stirling, Dunblane, Alloa, which makes a significant change. Plus also the commercial team within Scotland has now moved into a more matrix managed structure, which is increasing the level of transparency across my team. So instead of it coming up into a hierarchy as it used to do, there's now much more internal transparency and challenge as well. Plus the change in reporting regimes that I've already instigated within both Scotland and London North East. So we're making a number of internal changes to strengthen the way that we deliver electrification projects anyway. With respect to the timetable changes at Cleland.
Can I respond to you in writing on that after the meeting, please?
Thank you.
Okay, I think we'd like to now move on and look at the Borders Railway, which is probably not surprising. Because it has been in the news, and I think again John Finney was going to talk about that.
Thank you, Gina. Dwell on the negatives, but I think it's important to say that the good work that you and your staff do is appreciated. And so, in relation to the Borders Railers, I'll roll this into one big one. Issues about crew shortages, signal failure, the overheating of the Class 158 units, the projections, and how that would fit in with the improvement plan requested by the Transport Minister. Can you comment on all of these, please?
Yes, Vinny, thank you very much. Yes, the Borders is just a fantastic railway, and the people... Our people that work on the railway are making a fantastic contribution, and the customers are just brilliant. And it's a big success. The first year has brought us challenges. And if I can start with crew shortages. Clearly, during the industrial relations strike we've had, we've seen an impact on crew availability. That is unfortunate. That is why it's important for us to have closed off the strike. And we did so this week with an agreement with the RMT and with ASLEF that was reached on Monday evening, which have taken a lot of work, but has given us a win-win outcome on the strike. But more than that, we have had challenges with new equipment. And without boring the committee and being short, as the convener has asked, there's this thing called axle counters, which actually determines for the signaling system where a train is on the railway. And these have performed really badly. And so we've adjusted, as part of our improvement program, we've adjusted our maintenance regime, which should be like every once a year to every 6 to 8 weeks. We are sending people out to recalibrate these and reset these axle counter heads and to get us to give us the maximum assurance that they'll perform. We had a maloperation on Monday morning this week again, and it affected services. On top of that, we're doing non-destructive testing, which we are leading with Siemens, the supplier, as well as destructive testing. And we're doing everything possible to get our equipment to be in a state where it performs better. Now, very often on the railway, new equipment that come onto the railway is not as reliable as you would want it to be. On top of that, what we have seen in that area is power supply interruptions, and we are now looking at considering to what extent we can ameliorate that problem by putting UPSs or universal power supplies on to fix that particular problem. And there, just by discussing that one issue, I've given you a sense of this extent of focus that we are bringing to problems such as that. On infrastructure problems, I cannot convey to the meeting how dedicated our teams are and how our teams, really fantastic, good people on the ground, are doing everything we can to focus on where the issues are and fix them. You would have noticed in the press there's a lot of commentary about how much of the route is single-tracked, how much is double-tracked, etc. Don't want to particularly be drawn into that, but to say... Yeah, right.
So I hope to draw you into it.
Yeah. So what I'd like to say, Mr. Finney, is there's always a balance. If there is more double tracking on that route, it would definitely provide more flexibility. It would definitely provide us with more of an opportunity to recover from delays. But similarly, there are other things we can do potentially with a timetable. And we're working exceptionally closely with Transport Scotland. And I can say that again, the relationship with Transport Scotland is very open, very positive. The lessons we learn from this will feed back to Transport Scotland and look at what other choices need to be exercised to make the railway and the timetable more robust. And again, this is about an output, not necessarily about an input. If I can talk a little bit, and I just want to show the meeting this as well, if you can see, and I'll send it around, but you would have seen this thing about radiators on the Class 158 fleet. Now, that's what a radiator looks like. And from the one side, it should have very bright, hot water. There's an infrared photo. And as it goes through the radiator, it should become dark. Yeah, so from that side to this side. It should become darker to show that it works. And you can see this radiator design is not really working. And it's been on the Class 158s for a long period of time. Like two-thirds of the radiator is not really effective. And so we saw this at the beginning of the hot days. And what happens when the radiator gets so hot? It just cuts the engine out. So the engine runs at lower power. So now we struggle up Fella Hill and start to lose time, and the time loss gets captured for us. So what we have done is we've first looked at how we clean the radiators in case there were contamination affecting it. But in the end, we've got a new radiator design. We're busy refitting the old fleet. So the problem will be removed for next year. And just the focus on things like this will put us in a better place with performance in the long run. Your comment about the overall performance improvement plan is also really important. And if I can say this again, as railway people, we understand when our customers are affected by punctuality not being where it needs to be. Currently, our punctuality is about 0.6 of a percentage point away from where we would want it to be. It's at 89.7% instead of 90.3%. However, our customers have had a very rough summer. We've had industrial relations issues. We've had strikes. We've had a number of serious failures on our OLE system, overhead line system, which have caused significant disruption. We are spending more than £8 million now on specific reliability improvement programs. But more than that, we're not just throwing money at performance. We are also focusing on how the railway operates on a day-to-day basis and how our people work together to make sure that trains depart on time, doesn't lose half a minute here or there, and we will, over the coming weeks, continue to retain that focus and work towards improving the punctuality of our service. Needless to say, periods of change where we are asking customers to bear with us when we do Winchburgh Tunnel, when we do Glasgow Queen Street Tunnel, when we have at nights longer access to give Carl more than 1.5 hours to get the electrification done, all of these things affect our customers, and I understand that. And there is nothing worse for me than to have customers being dissatisfied with our railway. And we take it very seriously, and we'll focus on the next couple of weeks and months to improve the performance on our railway.
Okay, thanks. That's a very comprehensive reply. I appreciate that the effort that goes into the design and future-proofing that you talked about earlier with projects, and I appreciate that neither of you gentlemen were part of the decision-making process of the layout of the Borders Railway as presently configured.
clearly it impacts on some of the challenges that you face. It will also compound difficulties about the expectation a lot of people have to expand that line. Would you agree with that?
I'm not sure. I think the extension of the borders line to Hoek and even further has gripped the imagination of those communities, quite rightly so. If you look at...
To say that that quite understandable expectation has been impacted by what could have been fairly modest double tracking and loop opportunities that weren't put in with the design as it now is.
I think honestly, as we get a sense of how this railway, this part of our railway, the borders railway, works, it takes time for things to settle down, and we are now in a mode where we can see what it's shaping up to be. There are real opportunities for us as a train operator and Transport Scotland to agree what can be done to change the effectiveness of how this railway works. And so I think there's a very real opportunity to go back and think about either different timetables or further infrastructure investment. And I think as part of the benefit that it brings, if we look at feedback from Abbotsford House, just for example, in terms of footfall to Abbotsford House, footfall to business in Galla Shields, it is a huge economic contributor, and I don't think that some of the difficulties we've experienced now and which we are fixing will affect that as a business case for further extensions of that railway.
Okay, many thanks.
Yeah. Come in there, John, and say that I think that everyone's wanting the Borders Railway to be a success and to provide what people need. So I think it's something that we'll continue to watch, and I'm also mindful of time, as I keep saying. And one of the issues that we'd like to talk about is the issue of the recent dispute. Since the papers have been prepared for the committee, there has obviously been some movement. And I wondered if you'd like to just update the committee on that before we have a couple of questions for you on it.
So what we have agreed with both our RMT and ASLEF unions, RMT representing conductors and ASLEF representing drivers, is a dispatch method for new trains whereby the driver will stop the train and open the doors, and the conductor will close the doors and do the safety checks on the platforms. This proposal has come after, as I'm sure the committee appreciates, after a very difficult period of proposing solutions. This was the sixth or seventh variant of the original proposal, but this is a proposal that presents benefits for both parties.
Okay. Marie, that you've got a question, I think. Did you?
I appreciate that the situation has changed since we had these papers, and thank you for the update. So it is just to clarify then that there isn't a plan from here on in to extend the driver-only operation.
So we've not agreed on, we couldn't get agreement on the on drivers operating doors. We were never suggesting that there will only be a driver on the train, but mm-hmm. The railway terminology of driver only operation pertains actually to driver only operation of the doors, and it's so misleading to the public, because that was immediately read as driver only operation of the whole train. It was always our intent to have a second person. We now have a solution that has that.
Okay, very quickly, John.
You did nonetheless have a significant number of trains that operated with just the driver, and that had implications, for instance, for disabled passengers, Mr. Lynch.
So, in parts of our network, we have an agreement to operate trains with a reasonable expectation of putting a second person on the train. And parts of our network, we do have an agreed process whereby if there's not a second person on a train, the train can depart and can operate. So that
wasn't it?
Yeah, I fully agree. It's less than desirable. And working very closely with our unions, having identified that there are some instances where we are where it would be better to make sure we have headcount increases. I have increased the headcount of ticket examiners to make sure that we have less of those instances. And over the last couple of weeks, we have reduced the number of trains that run in that format significantly.
Well, it's good that you've got a resolution that satisfies everyone.
Thank you, sir.
Right, I think.
Very short question. I understand with your contract with the government that you're able to seek compensation from them for lost revenue due to industrial action. Are you going to be doing that?
So under our contract, if we show that we have done everything reasonable to avoid or manage a dispute, we have recourse to go to government. Government have indicated to us right at the beginning of this dispute that the risk of industrial action resides with us as a business. So government has already been clear that for the revenue loss that we have suffered due to the industrial action, we do not have a recourse for that loss.
Stuart, did you have a very brief one?
It was just now that the 385s, the doors will be shut under the control of the conductor, is the button still being pressed by the driver but at the control of the conductor, or are you going to have to spend extra money refettling the 385s that are ready in course and those that you're going to order?
Fitting of door control panels will still go into the assembly process, and there's therefore only a few sets that have initially been built where door control panels have to be retrofitted. The door control panels will make up part of the fitment program on that fleet from this point onwards.
Thank you. Okay. The next question relates around passengers, and I think Jamie's got a question there for you on that.
Thank you, Convener. First of all, I'd like to say it's very clear that you're passionate about Scottish Railways. That comes across in all your answers. You did mention in one of your previous answers that customer satisfaction is of the highest importance to you. However, the National Rail Passenger Survey, which Transport Focus perform, does flag up some areas of concern, which I'd like to hear your views on. In particular, passengers' concerns around cancellations and delays and the way that you handle delays. There's been a drop in satisfaction levels with the way that they perceive you to handle delays, and also the overall satisfaction around the environment within stations in particular. Now, clearly some delays are caused by factors outside of your control. Cancellations in Scotland are often caused by weather, for example. However, many cancellations are caused by staff shortages, for example, as we've read a lot of in the press. So I wondered what your overall view is on passenger satisfaction and what you're doing to address that and to increase passenger satisfaction in Scotland.
Our focus as a business is on customers and customer satisfaction. And I don't say that lightly. Our whole business plan is predicated on growing our customer base. So we see ourselves not as a business that just operates metal boxes up and down two metal rails, but rather a business that succeeds in what we do for customers. Immediately, I do hold my hands up and say, this last year, there's been an incredible amount of difficult challenges. Even the Forth Road Bridge, while successful for some of our customers, affected other customers differently and also affected our punctuality. But let's look at delays. So on delays, we've done a couple of things. We've equipped all of our employees with mobile phones, and we've given them an app, a contingency app, which is really cool, because when there's a delay, you just press a button, it tells them, it says exactly what the delay is, which trains will be affected, what replacement bus services will be available, and they can then advise our customers. And that helps to get customers information to customers quicker. We're also modifying that same app so that we can issue it to our customers, so they can then do a journey planner. So they, on their way to catch the East Kilbride into Glasgow Central, tap in that they're going to say 15, half an hour before, say tap, and they'll say, this is the route you have to take because there's a disruption on the line. We also implemented on our app and our website something that declares where, what the, very similar to what London Underground does, here are our 31 top routes, which routes are affected currently, which routes are healthy. So that level of information we are working at to get out to our customers is significantly more, and we're just in the phases of rolling it out in the last year. And we need to do a lot more to inform our customers of this and get them to use this and be familiar with it. In the Strathclyde area in particular, I am concerned about how, because of the complexity of the network, how we get messages and alternative options for customers when a train's disrupted, what other choices they've got. So I've put my team, led by extremely competent director Jackie Taggart, has put together an idea of the Strathclyde Disruption Desk, which is, for the Strathclyde area, we're going to deal with disruptions in a different way that makes sure the person on the ground knows exactly what's happening in other parts of the network to advise customers immediately. So that's a big drive for us. But on top of that, one of the things that needs to be really effective is how our people actually think and behave. And we've got what we call an Inspire program that's focused on changing the behaviors of our people. Not changing the behaviors, just adding to it. Our business is based on super fantastic people working in our company. I mean, I go on the trains and I announce myself to our customers and I say, I'm Phil Verstappen, I'm the managing director, I'm walking through the train, throw eggs at me or whatever, but give me comments and tell me what you don't like. And be sure they tell me. And one of the things they tell me most is not, this is bad, that's bad. They tell me, do you know how super your people are and your people make your company work? It's fantastic people that run our business. So we continue to help them to understand what they can do during disruption for our customers. And perhaps a last idea, which we have also not yet successfully sold to our customers, but we have set up a number of really good, what we call ticket acceptance arrangements with bus operators. So if a service is disrupted, yeah, you can take your ticket and get on a bus and travel as if you're traveling on a train. It's not the same as a train. It's definitely not as good a product, but it gets you from point A to point B. And we've got deals like that with McGill's for Inverclyde, First Bus for the whole of Glasgow, Lothian Bus for Brigg to Edinburgh, Stagecoach in the Highlands for Inverness to Aberdeen and Inverness to Thurso, and so on. And we've recently closed similar agreements with Stagecoach East for Fife and Borders and Stagecoach West for Dumfries and Ayr. So we've done so much of these things that will help us to work the railway better, and we will now succeed. We'll now go out of our way to get that to our customers.
First of all, thank you very much for that in-depth answer. I am still conscious of the time, and I'm delighted to hear about this app, which obviously will rely on being able to get Wi-Fi on the train, which may be another issue that leads us neatly on to whether that's possible and to talk about rural railways. And Gail's first.
Thank you. And thanks for coming along. I think some of the questions are as a follow-up to when we met up in Thurso, and thank you for coming on the Far North Line and experiencing the opportunities and challenges that we face every day. I just wanted to ask a couple of questions. I'll try and keep them as short as possible. I was on the train myself last Friday from Tain to Wick. The Wi-Fi wasn't working and I was unable to get my work done, so I wonder if you could look into that for me. One of the questions that one of my constituents has asked me is about your pricing, how it's set, because he finds it quite high. I must say I disagree with that, because I actually found that the journey from Tain to Wick was cheaper than it would have been on the bus, even though it probably takes about 2 hours longer, but the scenery is beautiful, as you know. Network Rail, what are the plans going forward for additional loops? Because as you know, well, with our declaration, the Friends of the Far North Line have been pushing for loops for quite some time, and it certainly would help to improve the service, because at the moment, as you know, we're facing a 4.5-hour journey from Inverness to Thurso, which is quite challenging for a lot of people. There have been a couple of timetable changes. I'm just making a plea to reinstate the early morning request stop at Coleraine. I'm getting pushed here by the convener to probably shut up, which is unfortunate being one of the last questions taken, as I think that we do need to spend as much time on this as we spent on other projects. But that'll do for just now, and I'm sure I can put anything else in writing to you. Thank you.
I'll gladly take any other questions. But if I can just say, the Far North Line is very different to any other part of our railway. And what's different about the Far North Line, if you compare it to a typical commuter railway, the Far North Line is really inherently part of the local communities. It's such an important line, very similar to what Borders have manifested to be. And so on the Far North Line, we have, as part of the route study, improvements that will be made closer on to Inverness, and we continue to consider how we can get speeds in loops to be faster, which is something that Frank Roach have brought to my attention, so that we can get more flexibility in terms of how the timetable works. And so there's been no ambiguity about the importance of the Far North Line to us. In terms of our performance improvement plan, we have a Far North Line team that looks particularly at performance on the Far North Line and focus on how we improve that. In terms of tickets and pricing, the prices for the railway is people have a belief that it's set by the train operating company, and it isn't. The prices for tickets are set by the client, which is Transport Scotland, and Transport Scotland, I think, are really good to listen and to work with different groups to understand what their concerns are with ticket prices and the like. And so, in terms of the timetable changes that you refer to at Coleraine, I think what we have to do continuously on the Far North Line is to make sure that we have a timetable that's workable, especially on approach into Inverness, because so many people make important connections at Inverness, and that remains our focus. But I'll take the question away.
I mean, on the same issue, I mean, there are stations on the Far North Line, indeed the Kyle Line and others, that are being missed out in order to get the train to Inverness for those connections. There has to be better information for people at those stations who are just seeing trains pass them. Can I just maybe take you to the piece that was in the Sun newspaper yesterday, which appeared to be informed by the Scottish Government? There were certainly quoting Scottish Government insiders. And one of the quotes from that was that you have neglected everything north of Edinburgh. And in a way, that kind of, and that's maybe quite stark, but that you were saying 30-minute train service is fantastic for that part of the network, i.e. anything north of Edinburgh as well, kind of plays into that allegation. It also said that the Scottish Government had given you an ultimatum. What is the Scottish Government's ultimatum to you about improvements to services, especially north of Edinburgh?
So the Scottish Government has, quite rightly, approached us when our punctuality performance measure, which is the measure of how punctual our service runs, called PPM, dropped below a certain level of a trigger level of 90.3%. They expect us to have an improvement plan for performance at that level. This is not an ultimatum. This is practical contract management with us. Train service performance have suffered. We have had an awful winter with Gertrude, Frank, and Henry, which were three of the worst storms that have hit Scotland in a long time. If I give you an example at Lamington, where water levels are typically 1 meter deep in that part of the Clyde, it was 3.5 meters deep and touched the under deck of the bridge. We've not seen this type of weather in Scotland, and people say in Scotland you must be ready for bad weather. We understand that, but this has been extraordinary bad weather. Our response to the Forth Road Bridge, as the ORR has submitted to this committee as well, has been exemplary to help in the national context, but it has affected our train service performance with overcrowded trains significantly. We accept all of that, and we're not making apologies here. We're just saying we are passionate to fix performance issues in the railway. And so I don't see this as an ultimatum as such, but I do see it as a proper step for us to deliver an improvement plan. And that improvement plan we have submitted to the Scottish Government, and we will deliver that. In terms of some of the other comments about what was in the, and my reference to an half-hourly service in Aberdeen, was not made relative to the fact that it's north of Edinburgh. It was made on the fact that I think a centre such as Aberdeen and Inverness have had a service that for many years have been too sparse for the huge demand that we have seen. So that was the context of my answer. I think Aberdeen is a fantastic part of our network and very important to serve. We cancel 1.1% of our trains. And some of the data that made its way to the Sun, we hold our hands up. Data published on our website was incorrect and didn't reflect that percentage. And the Sun have reported on that again this morning. And we are perfectly in the same space as the Scottish Government is, that train service punctuality will have to improve, and we are committed to doing that.
Is it possible to get a note somewhere else to the committee of the lines that have an improvement plan in place?
All of the railway have an improvement plan in place. We are for example, the 8 million...
But on reliability, you said you had to put in improvement plans on when reliability fell below a certain level. Is it possible to get a note of those lines and those plans?
We'll give you a detailed answer on that.
We're now actually at the stage where the meeting has to come to a conclusion, but there are various questions that are still to be asked, notably questions on access to Waverley Station, the Scotland Route Study, and access to the track by steam trains. There are probably other questions that we'd like to just think about and submit to you, and I'd be very grateful if you would consider responding to those so the committee are informed, just purely because we haven't been able to get everything in on time. So that will come to you in the next week. I personally would like to thank you, as I'm sure all the committee would, for the excellent evidence that you've given. What has come across is a passion and a knowledge, and we look forward to getting you back to update us on how things are going and to actually hold you to some of the promises you've made as far as delivery.
Thank you very much, Mr. Gondino.
Just before I close the committee meeting, I would like to just make an announcement in that at the last committee meeting, at the previous committee meetings, there have been issues raised on crofting. I've seen the first draft of a work plan and a paper that is being produced on that, and it will be available on the 5th of October, which is going to be quite detailed, suggesting how we take things forward. So I want the committee to know and to be fully aware that that's coming down the track, because that seems to be a reasonable analogy today, and that I'm working on it. So as soon as that's available, we'll let you have that. And John, I know you've got probably something you want to say to me about that after the meeting, and I'll take it after the meeting. And I'd like to close the formal bit of the meeting now. Thank you very much, everyone, for your time.
Thank you.